Good evening. I'd like to welcome everybody to the February 23rd meeting of the Finance Committee here in South Deerfield. We have there's four of us present. We may have one or two more join us shortly, but we wanted to get started as we have quite a bit to go through. I think the first thing I'd like to start out with is, as usual, is the previous meeting's minutes. Does everybody, I pass out a copy to everyone. Doug, do you need a hard copy? No? Okay. So I don't know if there are any comments or questions on last week's minutes. It's
Regarding the senior center there's a statistic in there about 200 seniors consistently using the senior center and 300 to 400 at least once over the course of the year. Mm-hmm. I thought one important number that came up was that on a daily use, it varied between 10 and 30.
Okay.
Because it shows more about the actual facility and its need and use compared to, oh yeah, over the year we used 200 or, okay.
All right, so 10 to 30. I do recall that being
I believe
that
was
the
a
range,
number,
So 10 to 30 people on average per day. We can certainly add that when I submit, submit the minutes to Barbara.
Okay.
I thought that was pretty high.
Well, that's
those were the numbers, right?
I mean, that's wow.
Any other comments on that?
I thought everything else was okay.
Okay.
Myself too.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I will go in and add a line referencing that statistic for when we file our minutes with Barbara. And with that change, I would entertain a motion to accept these amended minutes.
I make the motion to accept.
And I'll second that.
All right. Yeah. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. So previous minutes have been amended and accepted. Just make a note there. Okay, so I just want to take a minute to talk about what we're going to be doing this week and the next couple of weeks. This week, I am looking to spend as much time as we can on individual budgets. The rec department is going to come out first. They're about wrapping up their meeting. We'll do that and then turn over to Barbara. There's a number of budgets, which she'll have a lot to say. And then there's a few things from last week that we started on that Doug will be able to fill in a few gaps for us on the senior center and some of the police budgets that we did last week. We're starting to get some aggregated numbers to take a look at the budget picture overall. Unless we end up a lot of extra time this week, I'd like to table that to next week just to try to get as many pieces as we can this week. Mm-hmm. And then the hope would be, as I had sent an email, to have a meeting on Monday next week because Tuesday is elections.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
So not only can we then use this space rather than have it be elsewhere, but also I think it might be informative for people for us to have that kind of initial budget overview meeting right before they go and make some decisions on the primary ballot that do relate to mm-hmm. town and budgets and things like that. So that's
with that, Dylan, on that Monday the 29th, I probably will be leaving up in New Hampshire around 4 o'clock, so
you may not be able to.
It'll be close. I may be a few minutes late.
It's going to be, if we do it Tuesday, we lose Mary because she's working at the election. So we're going to try to find the best, best time. Yeah. But that's what
but
we're
this is.
Shoot.
I can't change it. So
yep, I appreciate that, and we'll be sorry if we do miss you. But
I'll be in, but it'll be.
Yeah. Late. Are we going to try the 6:30 start time?
Also yes, I think. I mean, part of it's going to. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we'll see who can make it when to make sure we have enough and that we got everybody we can. But that would be the plan, and then going back to Tuesdays there from then on. Mm-hmm. Okay. With that, I guess if we can start with the rec department.
Do you want all of us or
whoever wants to come up can sit or sit there or. Cool. Sorry, Barbara. It's being.
What's the number on that one, John?
Sure. Check. It is 634-5110 is the first one, and then another one on the back of that page.
Okay. Yep.
And then the previous page has their narrative.
Yeah. Okay. Got it.
Hey, Skip.
Sorry, I'm late.
Not a problem. Let's see.
Here's the minutes. We accepted those. And we're just going to get started for the rec department.
What was the number? 6?
Right here. Okay. Where to go? Yeah. 6:34:5.
Yeah. Okay. How you guys doing?
Good. How are you? For those who don't know me, I know but most of you guys. Rob Ackerman, chair of the committee. Sue was up here along with Jeff. So I'm hoping that you guys got this brief summary.
I think if it's the same one we have, the mission statement and the department goals.
Yep.
Okay.
Basically, we're asking what we asked for in fiscal 2016, plus the cost of living for this upcoming.
Okay. Yeah, the appropriated budget's pretty straightforward, just being the salary. And then I don't know if you guys have seen, but in our copy, they've taken the rec director benefits and broken that as a separate.
I haven't seen that.
Okay,
yeah.
So that's something that Doug, if he is back out here, has been looking to do for all departments to basically try to start to look at true cost for
okay.
departments and lining up. You know, it's primarily insurance and retirement is most of the two costs to the different departments. We went through this with the police department last week when we talked about their budgets.
Okay.
And then I guess we started to have a conversation about just some of the programs. And then for people who may not know on the Finance Committee, how most of that's done through the revolving funds. So if you guys just want to kind of give a brief overview of that, any highlights of new programs or things you want us to keep in mind or know about?
First thing I want to talk about is how many programs we offer. And then I'll have Sue talk about the revolving accounts, things like that. Right now, if you go to the second page, I kind of broke this out. For children's programs, we offer 16 programs right now, plus scholarships for some of our student athletes.
I'm sorry to interrupt. You have a multi-page thing. We just have one page with the thing.
Yeah, we just got the mission statement.
That's all we got.
Do you have copies for them, Sue?
You have one over there?
She's getting some
over
there.
You have one. All right, so we got a few if you want to get started.
Dylan, if you go to the second page,
yep,
where it says children's programs. Currently, right now, we have 16 children's programs plus scholarships that we offer to our student athletes who have come up through the ranks, helped us, you know, with big events or they're refereeing for us or umpiring, things like that. We offer them to our seniors at Frontier, Deerfield residents. So we have 16 programs for children, and it's in detail. And if you go to the next page. We offer 5 adult programs, ladies golf, Nautilus, Pilates, yoga, Zumba. Family programs and community, we're offering roughly 7 for that. So we're talking about 30 plus programs that that we're offering for the town.
Good, thank you.
With Sue coordinating all of those.
Thank you.
And some of the numbers we just put together real quick. We're up about 250 people who have enrolled in these various programs over last year. So we're up over 1,000 people who have, you know, utilized these programs that we offer. So, we wouldn't be able to offer this many programs without somebody directing it. Everybody here has full-time jobs. I mean, there's no way with volunteer staff in this town that we could offer 30 plus programs.
Mm-hmm.
And if we kind of just look at the budget real quick, I mean, I did the math. Basically saying maybe 1/3 of 1% of the town budget will go to recreation director if I did it correct. So I think, you know, overall for 30 programs, I mean, I think that, you know, we're not really asking for a lot just to have a director to coordinate these for us.
Okay. Does anyone have any questions about the different programs before maybe Sue gives us her overview?
I guess I would just ask, there's a lot of programs, and what has been the rate of increase of the number of programs over the last, let's say, 10 years or so?
So you can speak better to that.
We started with only four programs. The town started with only four programs, soccer, baseball, basketball.
You know, you're basic, mm-hmm. you're three or four sport seasons.
Okay. And that was about how long when it started?
Oh. 17 years.
Okay, yeah. And what drives the increase of programs? How do those come to be? Who decides that?
The committee will vote.
Okay, so it's the rec committee.
Yep, we'll mm-hmm. vote. And, you know, Sue goes to conferences, too, mm-hmm. to see and, you know, networking and see what other communities are doing. But we've really tried to think outside the box and do more community, family-oriented, you know, activities and mm-hmm. Offer things for our adults and our seniors. So, like I said, you know, most people think rec, you think baseball, basketball, soccer, that's it. So if you really look at all the detail on here, it's much more than that. So.
I guess my real thought or question was there something from within the community that pushes you, but it's really what
parents do ask, too.
Yep.
They do. Okay.
Yes, parents do
yep.
suggest,
that's
like the parents'
at.
Night
yeah.
out.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
I mean, that was something that parents wanted. I mean, it's mm-hmm. it's a pretty good deal to drop your kid off for a few hours and have them get a meal and play, and they get to go out to dinner or a movie or whatever. Mm-hmm. You know, parents mm-hmm. wanted that, and we're doing another one of those because actually they want one a month, but mm-hmm. it's a lot.
Yeah.
But we are
yeah.
going to be doing another one of those because they do, and the same with the movies. You know, they like the movies. Mm-hmm. Movie nights for the kids mm-hmm. to come for, you know, watch a free movie. It's, you know, it's free to them.
I guess my thought was just whether... You know, you're kind of observing what others do, and then we do the same, or whether it's really being pushed up, because being pushed up from the need is the best, obviously.
Yeah, and, you know, a lot is, because the kids not so much play sports anymore, they're doing other things, and so we're looking to diversify, too, into other areas besides mm-hmm. just the sport programs, because that's what people want mm-hmm. now. That's what people want.
But a lot of this does come from the parents' desire.
Some,
mm-hmm.
yes, some.
Yeah. Okay.
I get a lot of ideas when I go to those conferences. I get a lot of ideas and see what's working in other mm-hmm. communities. And you know, granted, they're usually much larger than we are, but you know, it's something that we can pull off here.
And all these programs are self-funded or
yes,
donations.
All of our programs are self-funded. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah. I have friends.
Four. Right.
I have friends in surrounding communities and. They're amazed at how much stuff that we offer. I have friends in Shelburne Falls and Northfield who want to come to Deerfield to do Deerfield Rec because those towns out there may just have one person who's in charge of baseball, and when the money comes into that one person, how mm-hmm. safe do you mm-hmm. feel with that?
Mm-hmm.
Here, we run a professional program. We do Corey checks on all our coaches. Everything is professional. We have professional signups. You know, it all the money comes in, goes to accounting, things like that. So it's all, you know, run very, very professionally. And I like to think that we have, we give our kids, you know, we set them up for success till when they get over to Frontier. I mean, Frontier speaks for themselves when it comes to sports. We win Western Mass championships all the time. So mm-hmm. a lot of these kids have started, you know, in Deerfield Rec.
You have to eliminate programs sometimes because of new types of programs coming in, or
no? The only time that we get into a little bit of a bind is when we can't get a coach, but that really hasn't. We've hadn't had to eliminate anything yet, Sue. Right? We mm-hmm. usually can get somebody to fill in.
I can see where that would be.
Yeah.
A potential
so,
problem.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. In the past couple of years, we've actually dropped the budget from when we were asking $4,000 to $5,000. I think that helped offset expenses. Mm-hmm. So basically, we're just asking for. Mm-hmm. You know, her salary, so.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Good.
Yeah, and you know, obviously, you know, the town's making a decision to have a rec director, to have more than just what you'd get with people trying to cobble things together on a volunteer basis.
Yes.
And clearly, you guys are coming through on that. You know, I don't use all these programs, but you know, summer concerts are great right here in town, and Old Home Day, I know everybody
it
really loves.
It brings the community together. It really does. Mm-hmm. Whether it's dropping the kids off for practice and watching a game, summer concerts, Old Home Days, things like that. You know, it brings everybody together.
Sure.
And we also use a lot of high school kids, you mm-hmm. know, as referees. Some of them help Here. Coach. There's a, you know, they'd help with skills assessments in baseball and softball. We use, you know, they come do umpiring. They also are CITs in our summer program. That's a, they, everybody wants to do that. Our summer program has grown immensely in the past, you know, in the past year.
C what? CI?
CI, a counselor in training.
Oh.
So we have a couple counselors, but we always have like 10 or so kids who also want to come, who don't get paid, who want to mm-hmm. come help out.
Okay.
Well, and, you know, they help in our at our movie nights. They help at our parent nights. They help at our Santa's workshop.
It's great training for the kids.
Yep.
It is.
Yeah. We had kids from Frontier and Deerfield Academy help with our soccer program, mm-hmm. you know, for the little kids. And so, I mean, we have a lot of community support from over there, too. And, you know, the kids love it. The older kids love it, and the younger kids love it, too. They all, you know.
Okay, and then just a brief overview of my understanding, and you feel free to jump in on how the revolving funds are working. So basically, there's two main revolving funds. One is basically all the fees from the programs coming in and then going out to fund mm-hmm. those programs, which, as they said, makes the programs themselves self-funded. And then there's another account for any gifts that do come in. And so I believe, as you said, some of that is kind of restricted to certain uses, and other it is yeah. kind of used for things as they come along. So I guess my only question would be, you know, do you see any things coming along that might be larger repairs, whether it's dugouts or irrigation or this or that, that you'd want us to make aware of, even if it's not this year?
I would say the irrigation system out here is now going to be 17 years old. We do have a little bit of money in a baseball account from when that was turned over to us. But, you know, every year I do have to put between $300 and $500 out there yeah. because of a broken sprinkler or something. That's been happening the past few years. Mm-hmm. And I don't know what's going on under the ground, but, you know, it is getting older.
A couple of things, too. A lot of our equipment is stored all over the place. We have equipment down at Sugarloaf Field. We have two sheds that are in dire need of repair over here in the corner. The Butler building, we store some stuff. These two sheds over here are, you know, they're in repair. So at some point, I'd like to be able to have one, you know, main building to house all of our equipment. It makes it just so much easier. That's my vision down the road. I'd like to have something like that. And plus, we also keep equipment up at Old Deerfield Field. We have a shed up there, so a central location to house all our equipment would be great. Like I said, that's my vision, but these two sheds out in the corner, I think, are at the point where at some point we'd like to be able to do something. So okay. Doesn't need it this year, but like you said, looking down the road.
Well, that definitely makes sense. Before we get trying to repair, replace, or build new sheds, to have a larger conversation, is there some other centralized location
yeah.
we can work towards?
I'd like to look at something like that.
Yeah, you know, that's where we can bring in, you know, Kevin, as you know, knows all the town
right.
facilities, yeah. kind of where things are, what we have,
that
what you guys need.
That makes a lot
need.
Of sense.
So, okay.
Also, with the school kind of population shrinking, and there's been background talk about excess school building facilities and that type of thing, whether there's any conversation that, you know, people like Kevin could have with them to see. Of course, I don't know where your fields are and where the elementary, are they kind of close? Or
basically, we're using Sugarloaf Field. We're using right here.
Right up back.
Right up back here. So do we use the elementary school a lot much?
Yeah, we use that for baseball.
We use that for yeah. baseball. Mm-hmm. We use Old Deerfield baseball field, and we... Do we have an agreement with for the soccer field over at...
we use Channing Beach.
Channing Beach.
And we use Deerfield Academy
yeah,
fields
Deerfield
and Eagle
Academy.
Fields, too.
Yeah.
So, I realize proximity is important,
yeah.
you know, but it's just a thought. That's
yeah. We're kind of unique where, you know, we don't have the complex, you know, where we're
right.
everything there. We're kind of all over the place, and we do the best we can with it. Sometimes it's a struggle
getting fields lined out and, you know, getting soccer goals out. Kevin at the highway department is a great help to me. He helps me all the time if I need stuff. So, again, talking about another vision, I'd love to have a complex in town where everything could be together. But
okay. All right. Anyone else have any questions or any other things you'd like us to know?
No, well, I just would like you guys to really support the rec department. I, like I said, we offer over 30 programs, and I think it's a big part of this community. I'm just asking for your support.
I think it is, too. Kudos to the committee and all the volunteers that are involved, because it does make a huge impact on the people that are involved with all these programs. I think it's a good thing for the town.
Yeah, I'd echo those sentiments. I guess the only question, maybe, Doug, if you could help us here. We noticed that we have a new breakout on the rec department benefits. And as this is kind of our first go-around going through these types of budgets, if you could just kind of walk us through to see what we got.
Make sure I'm looking at the right thing.
Sure.
Tilton Library, rec department. Okay. I'll move that down so Jonathan doesn't get upset with me. For every salary line item in the budget, as a first step towards sort of creating a little bit more transparent of a budgeting system, we've tried to provide estimates of benefit costs for any town department that has staff. I want to reiterate that the numbers that are in the rec director benefits category are not real numbers for group insurance. That number basically represents an average amount for any given insurance eligible person in the town. So as to protect confidentiality, particularly in this case when we're talking about a single staff member. Excuse me. The retirement is based on current figures. Excuse me. For retirement, as we got from Franklin County Retirement System. And the other refers to an estimate for Medicare costs as well as life insurance costs, if any. So that number that you see at the bottom of that page represents a rough estimate of HR costs for that department. Okay. And the same goes true for any other benefits budget sheet that you'll see with any of the other salary line items in the budget.
And do retirement and other mimic group insurance, and that is just a straight average, so it will be kind of a similar
actually, in the case of the retirement, that is the that's a calculation, and the calculation, excuse me, is based on a percentage of the salary paid to the employee. And I believe I've got to go back and check. 64, 51, 10, salary schedules. 18.91%, correct.
Okay.
Medicare costs are about 1.45%.
Okay.
So there we are.
Well, I think it's a valuable thing to have. It just keeps us all focused on it. The specifics isn't important. It's just the overall picture.
Right.
That we've got salaries and we've got benefits, and all put together is what we need to keep, all townspeople want to know, need to keep in mind. This insurance thing brought to mind, too. Liability with regards to the rec. That's all under the town.
I would actually defer to the rec commission on that. I'm not well versed in that, and perhaps our town clerk is here. She may be able to speak to that as well. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's under the town's general liability.
Yeah.
Then there you
I'm
go.
Just thinking of volunteers and workers and so forth.
That's how I've always it's been explained to me. The same. Yeah, it's been explained to me that. And I've been around for a while, and I've always got the same answer to that. Yeah.
Okay. I just assumed.
Good question.
Make sure it's covered.
And just for anybody at home or not familiar with it, so when we're talking about these benefits, insurance, retirement, other for rec director or any of these are not additional new benefits and costs. The town had kept all of them under the umbrella just within the town budget, and these were single line items. And now what Doug and others in the town are looking to do is to apportion them out to the different departments so that everybody can see kind of true total cost of each department and not just this one kind of lump sitting in the town that you don't know where it exactly is going. So just so everybody's clear on that. If there are no other questions or discussion on this, I would look to entertain motion, I guess, first on the rec department director's salary of, I see, $43,977.
That's really the only.
Oh, that's with the COLA.
Yeah. That's the, that, Dylan, is that 1.7?
I see 1.7% increase.
Is that what it is?
That is correct. Caveat being that that's an estimate.
Yes, the 1.7 is not still set, but will be set across everybody, and whatever that is will apply here. So if that does change, we'll have to revote the new number, but it'll be whatever that number is. Anybody?
I'll move the direct director's salary and benefits as presented.
I'll second that.
Okay, so I guess since there are two, we'll vote first just the salary. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
That's unanimous. And then, so now I'd entertain a motion for the rec director's benefits. Here we have the number set at 15,930. Okay.
There's
not.
Again, to reiterate, that's just an informational number.
Oh, okay. So you don't want us doing this. Okay.
Well, you can vote on it. That's great. That's wonderful. Yeah. For or against, it won't actually affect anything.
Sure.
Because by virtue of her status as a more than a 19-hour a week employee, she's eligible for benefits, and
it's all part
town
of
pays for retirement. And
so these breakouts are just so that when we go and you can see them,
only.
You don't need us. So we'd vote group insurance the big number, and
that's
then the apportioning would, okay.
That's correct.
All right,
it
easy enough.
Show support, that's all, but it's not.
I think just for the sake of simplicity, we'll just not vote these benefit budgets, but we do certainly support what you're looking to do, and that's you the getting way. The benefits that
yep.
that you do. Okay, I think that's it then for the rec department. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
So now, unless anybody has anything they'd want to quickly go over first, we're going to turn over to Barbara to go through a handful of budgets. Everybody good with that?
Yep.
Okay. Floor is yours.
Oh, my. Without any guidance.
ten seconds ago, there was nothing
I wasn't sure
on that
where
desk.
We were start.
All of a sudden, it's like.
I'm happy to start anywhere you'd like. Group insurance is a hot topic. If we want to start there while we're nice and strong.
Sure. Why don't we? Do you have a budget number in front of you just so we can find it in our large packet here?
Oh, yes. As far as an account number?
Yeah.
Yep. It is
914-5400. There we go.
Basically, the way I've been moving forward with the group insurance is figuring at this point, actually, we put these budgets together in November, but I had gone back, I think, a few weeks ago anyway, to update it. So I try and go basically on the actuals of this current year. So that's why I wanted some time to go by, the actuals of this current year, so that I know it's kind of evened out at this point in the year. You know, when teachers come in September and people are coming on and off and that kind of thing, it's a little hard to tell where we're gonna end up as far as who's got what policies and that kind of thing. So. It generally by January.
This current year, you mean calendar
what
year
we're
2015
in right now.
Or yeah. fiscal year?
Fiscal year.
Yeah. Okay, gotcha.
Yep, this fiscal year. So we're halfway through the fiscal year. So I have a good sense. It's been pretty level for the last couple months as to where we'll be at the end of the fiscal year. And,
okay.
you know, again, it can kind of bobble around in the fall, when, especially when teachers come and go and what have you. So based on what we actually have for policies right now, I take that number and factor in any rate increase for the plans, which we're having one this year, an average of 6.8%. And
6.8%.
It's 6.6 on one policy and 7.6 on another policy. Those policies aren't taken advantage of as much as the 6.6, so that's why it comes out to 6.8.
Mm-hmm.
And then an approximate 2% just for the chance of movement between open enrollment and teachers and things. So I just want to let you know how I came up with this number.
Mm-hmm.
So it's based on what's actually happening. what I know is going to happen in the rate increase, and then a 2% just for what I don't know.
Okay. And do you have the numbers of last year's estimate and then where we got to, like how over underfunded that budget will be when we get to the end of FY16?
Yeah, roughly? I think FY16 is going to end up pretty much okay. We had some reduction in staff at the elementary school, so that saved us a couple policies. And I think we were kind of, we kept that in mind when we put together the budget last year, thinking that we're not going to really build in a big, cushion of any kind, if you will. And we didn't have a rate increase. Well, it was a small one. It was a 1% or 1.5%, I don't recall, but.
Okay.
Let's see. I think Brenda had cost out the other departments that contribute in, if you understand what I mean. Mm-hmm. So I think my group insurance budget total should be pretty good. And I really think we're going to be right on target. We might end up a hair ahead. We had some retirees that qualified for MedEx, and so those kind of changes are just impossible to kind of forecast. So everything went on the good side this year, not on the bad side. Sometimes you end up with a lot of family plans that you had no idea were coming, mm-hmm. and I think this year, if anything, we ended up on the good side where our costs went down just a hair. So.
Okay. Makes sense. And can you give us any perspective on the drivers of the increase and then what that means or what we should start to think about might happen years down the road? Do you think mm-hmm. this is more one-off in nature or more endemic of things that could happen going
well,
forward?
If you look back at a longer history than the last 5 years, rate increases were just a thing that just happened. Mm-hmm. I mean, they were double-digit rate increases. They were pretty standard things. Your group insurance plans were going to go up. Over the last 5 years, we've been kind of spoiled and we haven't had a lot of increases. We had a small one last year. We rest on the strength of the Hampshire Group Insurance Trust in that we're part of this big group of people that we can achieve lower rates, and we've enjoyed great plans at a really reasonable cost, especially in the climate that's been across the nation in the last few years. Health insurance is going up. The strength of the trust has kind of buffered what we might have seen as rate increases with capital. They've been kind of offsetting some of what we might have had to pass on as rate increases through capital investment and hedging off the increases. So I think we'll probably see increases over the next couple of years. I mean, they're a group of really small towns. They're very conscious of the town's budgets and those kind of constraints and people's budgets. Any increase that goes up not only affects the town, but it affects the employees. So, but I don't think we'll see the no increase rate on group insurance again for a little bit. Prescription costs seem to be, when you look at the numbers, those are really going up at a great rate.
Now, in previous years where, let's say, and I don't have it either, maybe it was 1.5% last year, do you
yeah.
get two numbers that say, okay, this is the actual increase in the plan, and then this is the change in your assessment, and then the difference, as you said, has to do with the returns
of the
trust?
It's not an assessment. It's
or,
just whatever
I guess
plan.
Not an assessment, but
yeah.
the cost that the town's actually being asked to pay? Do you ever see that? Like, do you know what the actual plan increases were over the past few years, even if mm-hmm. our actual costs didn't go up by that much?
Our costs are the plan costs. So
oh,
I don't know
okay.
if I'm asking, I don't know if I'm understanding your question. So if there's a family plan that costs $1,500 and we pay 65% of it and the employee pays 35%, so if it goes up $100, then ours goes up $65, mm-hmm. you know?
I guess I didn't understand then, you spoke about the capital returns mm-hmm. or capital appreciation of the trust mm-hmm. having to do with, or at least partly having to do with the increases being smaller. Mm-hmm. What did you mean by that then, I guess?
Well, I mean that the group is almost like a private insurance
of their own. They pay their own claims and what have you. So if they want to say, okay, we have $2 million in claims or we have this kind of exposure, if we put $500,000 in capital and we only have $1.5 million in claims, then what is the rate of the plans going to be to share that? And this is a very layman's term because I'm by no means an expert on group insurance, but that type of offset to keep the costs that are handled by the group plans to a minimum.
Okay. Well, and as we had spoken about before, you know, mm-hmm. I'm still trying to come up the curve a little bit on exactly how this works, because it is interesting to me that the plan does, or the group does seem to have some degree of freedom from the actual cost of the plans year over year. And I don't really know what it is, but that's me just trying to educate myself. Either way, that's more for down the road. I think that the budget in front of us certainly makes sense. You certainly have put your work in to estimate or track FY16 and help use that to estimate FY17.
I will say that this budget is the one budget that, best way I can explain it, will work up instead of down. And what I mean by that is what I'm looking for as a net there, the 820, is based on departments who are going to offset our full bill, and this will be the net. So I've kind of figured what I think their actuals are, just like I figured what our actuals are. Mm-hmm. But if one of the department budgets comes in higher, perhaps they know something I don't know, or they want to budget for something I don't know. Mm-hmm. If that goes up higher, it would force our expense to go up higher, and our net would not change.
And now,
just going forward, when you talk to the other committees,
now,
the boards.
On this sheet, it seems that it's just wastewater treatment and South County EMS that are actually showing up as line item offsets?
Currently. But there's another department that could have an offset that doesn't currently have one, and I don't know what resides in their budget, what they plan for next year.
Okay.
So I'm just saying whatever happens, the net shouldn't change if something comes along different than the numbers I have here that would force the top number to change.
Makes sense.
Which department is that?
South County Senior Center.
Yeah.
Okay.
Those departments that are shared by other towns, right.
Mm-hmm. We don't have any number for, okay.
Right, right.
Well, actually, the expectation is that there will be no insurance costs for that department.
That's right, so.
Okay.
Could I ask you, can you tell me what plans that we offer, what are they? Individual, family, and?
Well, we have two types of plans. We have a PPO and an HMO. The PPO, you can have a family or an individual plan. And the HMO, you can have a family, a plus one, or an individual. And so you might see a change.
Family and
an employee plus one.
Oh, a plus.
So just maybe a husband and wife, or a, a parent and child, or something. I think those are the areas that the group trust as a group are going to be looking at as should we make some changes in what we make available in plans or deductibles or what kind of things do we want to do to contain the costs and still have a great plan? So
these are the plans that the town of Deerfield offers, or these are the plans that are offered to the town of Deerfield from Hampshire?
Correct. The trust, everybody who's part of the trust has the same plans.
Okay. And what is the cost? Do you have the costs for each one of the plans for this year and for next year?
I do not.
Not here.
I don't know that I have it here, but
I can get those tomorrow or something.
Yeah.
Okay.
A family plan's in the vicinity of $1,500.
Mm-hmm. Per month.
Yes.
And that's gross.
Oh yes.
That's total.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
$18,000 for the year, roughly.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And the individual plans are in the 500s. I think one's 520 and one's 570 or something like that.
The PPO and the HMO.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, it's not a direct budget question. This group, this Hampshire group, two things. First of all, is the group strong and healthy and happy? Is it growing, or will it always stay the same? Is
nope.
One question.
They've taken on new towns the last.
Yeah.
They're selective. They look at their history of claims and that kind of thing, so they don't want to take on anyone who's going to spike the claims. or who has a history of high claims or something, or maybe be turning to a new company because of their claims or something like that. Right. So they don't always take on everyone who applies.
Right. The second part of that second question is, who, let's say in Deerfield, decided to join this, or who has the authority to join the program? How did that come to be?
All the treasurers are representatives at the advisory, and it's these kind of things that are approved are voted. Last year they came forward with what I think was like a 3% increase, and on the floor it ended up working out that everyone agreed on the whatever it was, I forget, 1.8 or 1.5% last year. So it's an advisory, and maybe Mary can talk to the history. I don't really know. I mean, it's been...
Well, I know it's been... I was on the executive board for 12 years, and it's a very hardworking group, and they do have... Whenever they have some surpluses from that they don't have to pay out for the month, example, they invest it so that that helps buffer any increases that come along. They used to have like a master medical plan, which was a very expensive plan, but they felt that that was one expense that we didn't really need in the plan. But they're, and as Barbara said, they're represent really controlled by the treasurers in there's 20 some odd towns.
I know. Something I was going to say about 30 or so. Yeah. They've had 30 towns.
I think it's a great thing. I'm not questioning that. I always look at what is this? Where did it come from? How did it happen to be, and why?
The towns got together because the insurances were rising so dramatically, and we're still under Blue Cross and Blue Shield, which, but because they self-administer it, they're able to keep the rates
keep the
down.
Cost down. Yeah, which is great. Thank you.
Let me follow up a little bit, because I'm not sure if you got the answer that you were looking for, or you got the answer that I thought you, to the question that I thought you raised. Who in the final analysis is the decision-making authority to stay with this or to go someplace else? For example, what's the state one?
GIC.
Yeah.
GIC. Who would make that decision?
The selectmen.
Yeah.
Would they?
I will say that they report their rates against the GIC and the coverage, and it's not even close in either event. It wouldn't be a money saver for sure.
But I guess, and I don't know if you were asking the question, how would that process go about occurring to change to something other than what
I think I thought I had gotten my answer, but in a way you're correct, Skip. That is the real bottom line to it. If it isn't working well or want to make a change, who instigates that?
Well, not only that, the state requires that the plan has to be better than the GIC plan to stay in it. So all the numbers have to be crunched and compared every year to make sure that we are getting a plan that's more effective cost-wise and benefit-wise for the employees. So it has to be judged every year, and the selectmen get a letter every year stating what the percentages are.
But I guess the question was, is it selectmen? Is it the town meeting?
There's an agreement that's signed by the selectmen, so I'm assuming it's the selectmen. It's been a long time since it happened.
I mean, it could in theory, be the treasurer, too.
I would say if I had concerns I thought there was an alternative that should be considered, I suppose I would present it to the selectmen, you know.
Right, Thank you.
Okay. Skip, did you have anything else you still want to look into before we voted this budget? Well, that being said, then
let me correct that. The budget that I'm looking at, I assume you're looking at the same one.
Yeah, that's good. Yeah.
The amount that the total appropriation from last year was for group health insurance, $935,000.
That was the total cost.
Not the net in the budget down the bottom here. The net is kind of what I'm focusing on.
I'm not sure I see something that says net.
Well, total appropriation, 805,413 for last year.
Yeah,
We don't have that on our sheet, unfortunately.
I don't have that on my sheet.
Do you have 8/20/532 for this year?
I'm just going to look over your shoulder.
Yes.
Okay.
8/20/32, yeah.
Okay.
So that's
allow me to.
I think last year's offsets didn't get into FY16 on.
Okay.
The sheets that you have in front of you do not include the offsets from last year, and that could be an error on my part. The total cost that the town paid was $934,967,
right.
I believe. Barb, please correct me if I'm wrong.
I believe so.
And from that, a certain amount was billed out to various departments. $69,491 to South County EMS, $11,679 to South County Senior Center, $25,110 to wastewater treatment, and $5,633 to shared teachers. In other words, the town essentially transferred money from those accounts to offset the cost of that $934,967. So the total amount that we paid, if my math is correct, was roughly, that came out of appropriation directly for this, or that was appropriated for this, was $823,054. That was just for the group insurance.
That's the town share, correct?
That's the town share. Mm-hmm. That's what came from.
I think in the end it was 805,413 is what the.
Correct. That included the life insurance as well, I think.
What was your total?
I'm sorry.
We discussed, last year we discussed having a $20,000 ACA kind of line item because we weren't sure what was going to happen with the ACA, but in the end we didn't put that in there.
Okay.
So I think right. That's where you're getting the 825 perhaps.
Correct.
It was 805,413 was the total appropriated out of this budget for group insurance.
Yep.
So to apples last year to this year is 805,413 mm-hmm. to 825,32.
Correct.
Which is just the town's portion
yep.
without the offset.
Yep.
Now, the 805, that includes life insurance, too?
Yes.
Okay. A 7% increase would be $50,000 to $60,000, and I only see a $15,000 increase. That's what I was getting at.
Mm-hmm.
Can you explain why you're only showing a 3% increase? Or
well, like I said, I didn't really go from last year's number and figure a 2% and then a 6% or whatever. I just looked at what our plans are right now, what we're spending right now, and have been over the next last few months or what have you, and then going forward with the plans times whatever their rate increase was plus 2%.
Mm-hmm.
So as it relates to last year, and as I said, when we started, I think this year we're going to end up on the good side of our group insurance budget. So
the 805
will have ended
was
up
appropriated
to be more than
that
necessary.
May not reflect what actually will have been.
I don't know that we'll need all of that as it turns out.
So
between whatever happened.
It's always in flux, and what you're
right.
trying to do is to bring us.
I'm trying to make it as accurate as possible because these are big numbers, and mm-hmm. If you start just rounding up and rounding up and rounding up,
we're going to pay for it anyway, so one way or the other.
But, yes.
It's not that I'm going to vote it down,
yeah.
but someplace along the way, whether I come in and see you and report back to the board, or a month from now,
sure.
as we get closer to town meeting,
yep.
we update this one way or the other.
Yes.
I'd like to see if I can get some. I need to get a better understanding, I guess. Of the.
Yep. Well, just to give you an idea, I keep a monthly. Mm-hmm. I keep a monthly and running total of.
We can do this. I can do this with you later. It's, I guess that's what I'm saying.
Oh well, I think everyone
and if
had.
If anybody else
the question.
Wants to.
Okay.
It's not. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, I think then I would like to. I would entertain a motion, and Doug, correct me if I'm wrong, we would be voting to appropriate the 825.32, correct? Yeah.
I think that sounds right.
So would anyone like to?
I'll make a motion.
All right. Any
second.
Second.
How much were you voting for?
825.32, which is the line on the budget.
825.
532.
Okay.
532.
Yeah.
820. Now that we got that set.
Pronunciation.
Yeah, no, it's
comma.
Comma.
Exactly. All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? No. Okay. Now
another,
what?
Another one to talk about while the night is young is workers' comp, and I would like to work with Doug on coming up with what we're most comfortable with. We have a new carrier or company, if you will, for workers' comp. They came on this fiscal year, this current fiscal year, FY16. So I had been a custom.
This is two pages prior, guys, if you're looking for just two budgets before.
912-5400.
Yeah, 912-5400. Sorry, continue.
That's okay. So I've been accustomed to figuring out this budget by the payroll dollars in a particular department times the workers' compensation rate factor and coming up with the total and then adding it up and coming up with things. So if I do that, what you're looking at is what I come up with. But when I talked to our new rep and I asked him, you know, what should I expect? This is the first time I'm creating a budget for you. I don't know, you know, is there going to be differences or changes? And so he said, you know, well, for round numbers, just figure a 10% increase. And I said, well, you know, that's a little rough. You know, how will I come up with figuring out these budgets each and every year? Can you send me the rates or something, you know, the department rates? So he sent me the department rates, and I came up with this, and it's nowhere near a 10% increase. So he came last week, and I missed him, and Doug sat with him, and I'm not really sure what he meant by the 10%, if he was just being extra cautious or... Okay. Or what? But aside from figuring the rate factor, mm-hmm. what other charges are there with a workers' comp plan, right?
Yeah, and that's still something that's a little unclear to me.
Yeah.
So the numbers we came up with, mm-hmm. which I think, I hope you've got in front of you.
57,284.
How much?
No. 59,67.
Oh, well, we might
I'm sorry, what do you have?
Oh, I have 57, but I might have printed an earlier version. What do you have, 59? I think we looked at it and we scrutinized it all over again, and we came up with like $2,000 difference than what we came up with the first time. So,
okay.
I think your number is probably accurate. I just printed this today.
I'm sorry, what do you have?
I have 50967.
Oh, 50? I don't know.
Yep. Anyone else have something different?
Cool. That's what I have.
That's old? Yeah. I have 57,284.
Is that before any offsets?
Yeah. Yeah, I don't have any offsets in there.
Your basic is 57?
Without any contributions from other departments.
It's on here, it's 78.
Yeah.
You have a gross amount of 57?
Yeah.
So then your net amount must be...
I know.
Very low.
I know.
Okay. Allow me to just take some quick checking.
Yeah, I would like to do something to solidify these numbers with
sure.
our new rep before we move forward, because he did send me the rates and I factored in the payroll for those departments by the rate and everything, and this is what I came up with. So okay.
Other than rate changes, is there anything that you see year over year with workers' comp that would change this number, or is it basically just the rate schedule?
Yeah, okay. That's the only way I've ever had to figure it. I can't imagine that there's any other, actually with Maya this year, we used to be with Mega, and Maya is known for giving kind of like good behavior points, if you will. You know, if you go to trainings and if you do this or you do that, you end up with kind of like rebates or little discounts back. And so he did tell me that he didn't expect there to be a workers' compensation, you know, rebate or discount throughout the year, where I think we got a couple thousand last year or something like that. But again, this is kind of a new experience with them, so...
Okay. Well, with that in mind, unless anyone else has a question, I'd like to just move on from this, because I agree
too.
We need to verify before
yeah.
we vote it. Right.
I would feel okay. most comfortable with waiting okay. on that one.
All right. What else? What would you like to do next?
Okay. from there, I don't think I have any other preference.
Medical Security Act.
Well, I was going to say, do you want to go in order? So unemployment is right there.
I'm looking 913. At unemployment, so that's fine with me.
Yep, 913-5400.
It's the other side of that workers' comp page.
Oh, yeah. I'm not sure where it is. Last year, we knew we were going to have some staff reduction at the elementary school, so we had factored that in. And, oh, for God's sakes, where is it? Okay. And this year, you know, I don't have any indication that anything like that would happen. So I kind of picked a middle of the road, if you will, and I put in $12,040. is that what you're looking at?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, good.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I don't anticipate anything. We've never really carried a huge budget for this.
How's it gone so far in FY16 for this budget with the 46 that we appropriated?
It's been an interesting year for unemployment. We have I have a company that you'll see the entry for $2,040, and they interact with the unemployment, and they kind of represent us, if you will. So whenever I have an issue, even if I have a labor question, I call them. But they have represented us on a couple of unemployment claims this year, and which we ended up going to court on and everything. So it's up in the air. It looks like it's going on our side, but they might still be awarded benefits. So this year, it's hard to say. We have expended money, but I'm hoping that we get that back or...
So do you think that the way that we went about this last year, kind of the approach we took, was a good one at the time, knowing that we didn't know what was going to happen?
It's funny. I don't really know that we did end up using money. I don't know if it was necessarily as a result of the reduction in staff, honestly.
Okay.
So
there's no way really of knowing.
There's no way of knowing.
This is a tough one. Just, I agree.
Even if you know there's going to be someone who's going to be laid off.
Sure. You don't know.
How long are they going to... just don't know.
Or will they go to work right away? Or yeah, it's really...
So what's the number? What I'm looking at here says $46,260.
That's 16.
Last year.
Well, it says FY 2017.
Okay, then that number is way off. It should read 12,040.
That's what
I see, 12,040, but it's the...
The one before you're
where it says at. FY 2017 Finance Committee recommended.
Then that's number.
Not sure.
Just ignore that. That's a typo.
All right.
Don't believe what you're reading.
No, we have in past years
at the
done.
Bottom, I see where you're looking now. Yeah.
5,000 and 8,000 or something like that. So, you know, I said 10,000 just because 5,000 really isn't going to pay very much of anything. I thought if one person goes, that will take the edge off it at least, you know.
Okay. I think that seems like a fairly reasonable approach.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think they can collect for like 35 weeks, and I mean, we're going to pay at least $500 a week if a full-time person goes, or at least biweekly. So.
Okay. Anyone else have any questions on this? Otherwise, I think I'd be inclined to vote this budget.
You looking for a motion?
Yeah.
Sure.
So are you going to make it?
12,000. What is it? 12,040.
40,040.
Mm-hmm.
And a second?
Second.
All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 All right. Unanimous. Okay.
Can I just ask a question on that?
Sure,
you just voted and now it's official.
Okay.
But I think we do a small offset on the 2040. We do share the with the South County EMS. So does that change your vote? If
that offset gets added in, we can revote this budget, so we can coordinate with Doug and you on that. And if the number changes, we'll revote that.
I'm just looking at that, and I'm thinking I'm pretty sure that we cost out a portion of that to him.
That's for
unemployment management.
Okay, I'm looking at the South County EMS budget. I don't see it anywhere.
Would that now be part of indirect costs now that we have that formula?
Well, the indirect cost comes into the budget as an other revenue line item.
No, I know, but instead, is that just sort of part of what we do and that's included in whatever that number is? I don't know.
No, it should be separate.
It should be separate. Okay.
Well, I'll double check. Maybe I'm just having a...
Or they're just not anticipating. It's one of those things where...
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, we'll make a note.
I think
we'll
they've
sort it
enjoyed
out.
The program, so I think they'll be happy to continue that. If we're just going to work our way backwards, account number wise, 9/11, 5,400 would bring us to retirement. And this one's an easy one to figure out because they bill us.
Okay.
What do you have, Doug? I don't have it here.
The number, I went back and I just double-checked the figure. Mm-hmm. The overall number?
Oh, here it is. Okay, I'm sorry. I have 474,543.
Is that your bottom line figure? Is that after offsets?
That's before offsets. That's just my number.
From what year?
Okay. I thought I went back and checked and saw a number of 496,669.
Yep, that's what it should be. Yep. 496,669. Is that what you all have?
Yes. Okay. And then we
have the notice of the assessment right here.
And we have a net of 366,451.
I have a slightly updated number because the offsets are probably slightly different from what you've got.
Okay.
South County EMS has an offset of 87023.
So what is your net number, Doug?
Well, South County Senior Center has an offset.
Oh, sorry. You have more.
8495.
That we have.
Mm-hmm. And wastewater, 27459.
Yeah. That we have.
Mm-hmm. For a total of 373692.
373692.
Okay. And are those numbers in their budgets?
Correct. Those are, I just got the South County EMS budget today.
I would.
And that 87023 is in his budget.
Now, is that the number? You should be giving them the number.
I was going to say, I would, I'd like to make sure that Brenda gets that because we're only going to get from them what. Mm-hmm.
Whatever's in their budget, yeah.
We're not going to get the budget item, whatever he budgeted, because if his payroll ends up less and therefore his assessment is less, then we get what the assessment is, not what he budgeted for.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Did I say
and
that?
If, and if it ends up being more, then you charge them more. So
we would charge them more, but I'm just afraid of reducing what we budget for by someone's
budget.
Possibly inflated budget, that in the end, if he budgets for $80,000 in retirement, and Brenda at the end says, geez, his payroll was only 400,000, so his assessment is, you know, by 19%, is only
80,000.
40,000, yeah. Then that's all that's going to be taken okay. from South County EMS. So I'm just afraid of what those numbers are, if they're just budget numbers or if they're actual.
So then wouldn't you and Brenda be going through looking at the assessments and the salaries for the different departments and you sending them what that number should be?
Well, just like I talked about in group insurance, we can give you a number what we think what we believe it's going to be.
Yes.
And if a department plans on expanding, especially something like South County EMS, because they're not really, you know, the selectmen aren't determining that. They might be deciding that they're going to expand or what have you. And they have a higher number in the budget. I would just be more comfortable about increasing the upper number and having the net stay the same. So I'm just cautious about the net because I haven't figured that net. And I don't know that Brenda figured that net. So it might be figured just on budgets.
Okay, well, I guess I'd go back to, and I think we're saying the same thing. I'd want to make sure that you're giving them their numbers. If they think it should be higher, then that's a conversation that they are going to need to have with the selectmen and us about mm-hmm. what's going on that's causing that. And if all that lines up, then
right.
we in concert with you will amend right. that number. But exactly. that's kind of the circle of discussion that would need yes. to happen in that.
Yes.
If South County EMS is budgeting $87,000 for, what are we looking at, retirement, mm-hmm. then, and if that number actually turns out to, let's say, be only $60,000, mm-hmm. then that means two things. That means that we've shortchanged Barb because she's got to pay the $496,000.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. No matter what.
Mm-hmm.
Matter of fact, we pay that, I think, on July 1st
yes.
to make sure that we get a discount. That's a discount mm-hmm. off of the actual rate, which would be 505 or something like that, by mm-hmm. paying it all at once.
Mm-hmm.
But it also means that South County EMS is requesting too much money
mm-hmm.
Because their number is off. There's one possibility that I could talk to Brenda to see if it's... if it's kosher to do, accounting-wise, which is to actually appropriate the full $496,000 for this retirement and then to reflect any offsets as an other revenue line item coming in.
I think she asked about that, and that was not
yeah.
accounting-wise
doesn't
the
work.
Way to do it.
Right.
Correct.
Right.
So let me ask a question. Let's assume that, let's just call it 500,000 for round figures. Mm. So we pay 500,000.
Yeah.
We don't use it, or it's off by.
Oh, we're going to use it.
We're going to use
that's
it.
That's the thing. That number's known.
That's a known number.
That's the point. Is there any refund, or is there any additional assessment?
No. But if that's known, then it's not entirely clear why a given department's wouldn't be known as well.
Well, it probably is known. It's going to be I think we decided it's just under 19% of a payroll. Mm-hmm. I didn't give you that number, so I don't know what payroll they're using to come up with their estimate. That's all.
Well, you should be using the payroll numbers that led to the 500.
You've gotten billed for this at 500,000.
Correct.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And that came from the Franklin County Retirement System.
Correct. Yep.
How did they arrive at that figure?
Yep.
I would just think you'd be apportioning that based on a snapshot of the payrolls as you see them now. If 6 months from now there's different additions and subtractions from various departments, that will go into next year's calculation that will rebalance and apportion whatever next year's numbers is based on the payroll at that point in time. Mm. No?
Changes every year.
Well, I know that. Yeah. That's what I'm saying.
It goes on payroll.
Correct. I'm just saying that I had no part of that 80,000, so I would just like to check that before it's taken off as a whole amount, because I don't know.
I agree completely. And I guess I'm just saying it doesn't seem to me it would matter if a given department is planning on expanding or not, because regardless, this is about what percent of the 500 is your department responsible for, which you'll be looking at the current state of departments and mm-hmm. kind of deciding that or apportioning that out, right?
Do you get a detailed breakdown? Do you just get a number? From what I've seen of the bill, you just get a number.
I just get a number, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So they don't tell us.
I think we're talking about how we're arriving at the apportionment to the department.
Yes.
No, we're talking about. I'm talking about the total. Where is that number?
The total comes from the retirement.
Right.
But where do they get that from? What's the breakdown?
It's that I could have you talk to Dale Kowacki, because that is beyond my explanation to you.
Mm-hmm. They use an accrual system, and that's how they. They have an audit done every year, and they audit our books every year. And they get an accrual from that, and that's where the rate comes out to go up to a unfunded liability. A portion of it goes every year. So
if we make an arrangement to talk with Dale, and mm-hmm. I can do that, and,
yeah.
which I'm more than willing to do over the next couple of weeks and get back to the board. So that,
what I believe we've done, just because to figure out how they come up with a 496 is you know, it's based on previous numbers and what have you. But I believe the accountants over the years, just worked it out to figure out what exactly is the numbers compared to our payroll, and therefore what is our percentage, so that we could handle things like
different
the South
departments.
County Senior Center, yep. the wastewater treatment plant. I don't know if our 19% is, you know, a perfect number. It's just that we needed a number to work with to cost out when we had to do it for wastewater treatment in the South County Senior Center. So
sure. That makes sense. And I'm on the same page. I think everyone is that, you know, you're going to be kind of directing the traffic on this, of looking at the number, looking at how we're trying to break it down to these three departments that have the offsets and giving those to them. If they see something drastically different, then there's certainly a conversation to be had. But otherwise, that's kind of where those numbers should come from.
Mm-hmm. The other concerns we have, and I was just talking to Brenda, is when you look at the South County EMS budget, I mean, currently they're doing like a lot of overtime, and that factors differently when you talk about retirement, and that doesn't really factor into. So if he's looking at his budget and he did 19%, but really, I mean, overtime isn't a retirement item. So we were just concerned about the numbers.
Okay.
So.
Well, like I said, that's something I think we can sort out. But either way, that'll leave us needing to vote this later once we have our net number.
Yeah, to be sure
where
that
you
we have
it.
The offsets as accurate as possible.
Okay, how many towns are involved with Franklin County Regional Retirement?
I don't know. I was going to say 36, but I have no idea where that came from.
Okay, but it's quite a large number.
Yeah, it's mm-hmm. again another group of. Actually, both of these are kind of endeavors of the. COG, is that true? The Hampshire Group mm-hmm. Trust is part of the mm-hmm. Hampshire COG, and mm-hmm. this, I don't know if it was offshoot of FERCOG, but...
I believe it includes all of the towns in Franklin County, excluding Greenfield, and I think Montague has their own also.
And some school districts, water districts. Mm-hmm.
I assumed it would be, but they can exclude if they want to, of course. Towns can exclude.
I don't think so.
You just said Greenfield is not.
Right,
right.
So I'm saying.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. They can create their own, but they have to have one.
Oh, of course.
They have to have one, but they can create their own.
Yeah, yeah.
So.
That was
given the complexity and the, it just doesn't, it doesn't make sense. You know, this district is, as far as I'm concerned, is too small. Greenfield is even smaller, and if Montague is even smaller.
I know.
You know, the liability.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, we're looking forward to being fully funded in that retirement, right? Do you have the year off the top of your head? Is it 2030 or something like that, or 2032 or something?
30-something.
Yeah.
30-something,
so,
yeah.
At
so
this
then
rate,
will...
they should be fully funded by 2020.
Doubtful.
Right, right.
Okay. If you were in charge.
Enough levity, huh?
So interest on temporary loans...
Did we do?
We're passing over.
We didn't. We're going to pass over.
Yeah.
We didn't do Medical Security Act.
We did not. We're just going reverse order, it seems.
Okay.
But we can do whatever.
We've always had $50 in there.
Yeah.
What's the number on that?
It's 918-5400. It's a few pages from where we were.
Just a little background on medical. The reason it stays at $50 is because one of these days the state may decide we have to pay it.
Yeah, I don't.
So they want a line item in there.
It's one of those that's very easy to vote.
Yeah.
Okay. Right. So are we talking about that, or are we going
to? I'll move the Medical Security Act at $50.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Perfect. Interest on temporary loans.
So are we voting the regional retirement, or
we are passing over that for now. We're going to get, you can certainly report back with anything you find on the top line number, and then Barbara and Doug are going to coordinate on the offset numbers.
Mm-hmm.
And interest on temporary loans is 752, 5900.
Yep. We've always budgeted for $5,000. It's just a little bit of money to pay if we owe interest on maybe an abatement or
what's the number we're working on? I'm sorry.
752-5900.
I have to take a temporary loan, you know, short-term note or something. That would be there.
Got it.
And how is FY16 kind of tracking on that line item? You think we'll kind of get right into around that 5,000 number?
Oh, yeah, okay. I don't know that we've. I think we've had just a couple of small expenditures out of there, if I remember correctly.
I think remember looking. Most of them occurred in the spring anyway, right?
Yeah.
Well, what?
I think we just had another tiny one.
Didn't you have to borrow money? This is really unanticipated.
Last year, right?
Yeah,
last year.
Yeah, last January or something like that.
Yeah.
And I assume the interest on that was out of this account.
Temporary loans is
budgeted. Yes.
That's the budgeted amount, yeah.
Where is it here?
That's the.
I don't have it in my list from her, but I would say we've maybe done a couple hundred as far as I recall. I'm accurate, but not much.
So this just gives Barbara the flexibility to. Mm-hmm. Do the short-term borrowing
pay the interest.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
Anyone have any questions on this? Otherwise, I'd entertain a motion.
I make a motion. We accept
that. All right. For 5,000, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? No. Okay.
Let's see. 751-5900 is interest on maturing debt. Working backwards.
That's fine.
I have 233,887.
That's not what we got. I have 279,714.
Okay. Interest on maturing debts.
Yep.
751. You have how much?
279,714.
Okay.
Can you give us a breakdown?
What is your number? I'm sorry.
233,887.
What have you got for breakdown?
We're not off by any of the exact amounts.
Have you appropriated anything in there in anticipation of the DES roof project?
No. I don't think we would. Would we have an interest payment in the on maturing debt in this?
The project will likely be closed out by December 1st. I don't know if we bond at that point or if we can bond
the
in
other, 19. The other issue or question that this budget brings up is the energy loan in itself. Hmm. I'm going to either have to, I mean, we've talked maybe either pay it off or turn it into serial notes or a bond or something, but we've been, you know, renewing this loan for as long as we can. So I guess.
What's your deadline, Barbara, on that?
The payment's due June 27th.
June 27th.
So typically what happens is I set up the refunding for the same day. So it's just kind of an in and out, and the difference is how much we generally pay down the $18,500. So whatever the day it's due is when I get the proceeds. $275,700.
And we would anticipate probably something in the neighborhood of a 3%.
Yeah, probably.
As opposed to 1% on the
bonds. Yeah. It would have to be State House notes or something, or serial bond or something. I don't know. It's kind of a small amount.
Sure. Energy loan, to address that one first, I think that's something we're probably going to a bridge we're going to be crossing a little later down in the cycle.
Yep.
To the extent that we move forward with that, with bonding it, we can then revote this budget to include the interest payment for that. And to the extent that we don't have time to do that, I'd certainly entertain putting interest payment in this budget, and then if we don't end up doing it, it'll just end up going back to the town at the end of the year. We don't want to leave you short options.
Right, and maybe after we get the override vote, or I don't know how you want to proceed on budgeting for the roof. I don't even know what to guess for that.
Yeah, so as we get closer to town meeting, I think we'll probably have more information on that, so we can put in something now. Whether we vote it or not now, we can always revote it later.
Mm-hmm. So you just want to hold on this for the...
Not just yet. Could you just talk about each of the line items in here so we just go through them, but then I think we will pass. So the roof, we spoke about that. We're all set. The energy loan, I see, and here has $2,500 in there. We spoke about that.
Interest, yep.
So then we just have the... I guess the it's just loan. The garage and the Oxford property.
And the land loan, yep.
Okay.
Yep. Yeah, and so those are on payment schedules, those two. So
so you have one.
Those are a given.
So you have 142,100 for the garage and 44,287 for Oxford?
Correct.
Okay. So it's just the other two is what's throwing our number off.
The energy loan, what do you have for that?
$2,500 for interest.
Okay. And what else do you have?
We have the
garage, 142,100.
Yep.
And the Oxford 44,287.
Yep.
I don't know why there's an entry that the accountant made to actual 4,500. I don't know what that would be.
I have no idea what that is.
45,000.
45,000. I'm sorry. Yes.
Again, I have no idea what that is.
And that's what's thrown. Yes.
Yeah.
That sounds like a typo.
Okay.
The actual one turns.
Without any estimates for the roof, the total for those three items should be 188. 887.
Yeah, I agree with that.
188 what?
1888.
I think in the explanation down below, I did the 45,000 as anticipated interest on the school roof loan.
Ah. Okay.
So I don't know why it says the language accountant adjustment.
Okay. Well, we know that there'll be somewhere between two and four line items in this when we actually come down to vote it. There'll be definitely Oxford and garage and potentially energy loan and elementary school roof.
Right.
Yeah.
And we'll put this off for now until we get more specific numbers on those two. Mm-hmm.
Okay. I think the same will hold true for the next one, maybe, the maturing. Or no, what do we have next? Maturing debt. I don't know if you want to...
Well, until we know what the roof is, it's tough to...
And what you want to do with the energy loan.
So, I think the same thing applies here.
Yeah, the energy loan, that's likely to be somewhat different.
Right.
That's roughly $280,000, is that what we said?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it's like $275,700.
Okay.
I might have it in here.
Well, there may be a way to get rid of that.
And, of course, our fiscal year 16 payment hasn't been applied to that yet. So that 18.5 has already been appropriated, would be spent. So that would go down to 275, 700 minus 18.5. So.
Oh, so it'll be.
Right, okay. Yeah, because we haven't.
If it hasn't,
we haven't paid
yes.
that yet. Yeah.
So the known is the Oxford in the garage, but the other two are still. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
We're going to pass over this one?
Yes, we're going to pass over maturing debt for the same reason as the previous. We'll pick both of those up when we have the answers to those two items.
Town clerk expense, 161,5400. Let's see. This is another interesting one. So originally I was worried about early voting and what might happen with that.
What's the account number?
161,5400.
Mm-hmm.
I see 26,187. Is that what anybody else has?
What number are we looking for?
161,5400.
Barbara, what total do you have?
I have 23,187, but I think I had revisited the town clerk expenses.
I think you went up on
you
elections.
Have for elections, Dylan, if you don't mind.
14,877.
Yeah, right. I think I had, I think mine is the earlier version.
So the 26 number is accurate, you're saying?
Yes.
Okay.
Please. We have a state primary in September, and then the November election. So that's what's playing heavily into this budget, as far as different from the year before, where we only had a town election.
Mm-hmm.
So, or well, 2 years ago. This year we have two elections in it. But anyway, you can see the kind of peaks and valleys in this budget, and it's largely just the election schedule.
Okay. How is the FY16 budget kind of as we're halfway through that?
Well,
with the 18,731 that we had appropriated last year?
Well, we're halfway through the fiscal year. We're not anywhere near complete with town clerk business.
Sure.
I haven't done the town election yet. We've got the primary next Tuesday. So those are where all my expenses will come.
So
I could better answer you in.
So this year we're having, so in FY16, we're having the town elections and then the primary,
mm-hmm.
which, and then in FY17, we're having the general elections and town elections.
We're at, no, and well, the state primary is in September.
Sorry.
And yes. Then the November.
That's right.
And then the town elections in May.
Okay, so we have two elections in FY16 and three in FY17.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And so how do you feel about the $6,700 that was allocated for FY16 to handle the two elections there?
Yeah, I'm hoping, you know, we get reimbursed a little bit from the state. And as it turns out, with the roof ballot going on there, I had an additional cost for ballots.
Mm-hmm.
I also kind of anticipate maybe another staff or two to handle what will be a very busy primary.
Mm-hmm.
And then we've got four primary ballots plus a fifth town ballot. So it's been,
okay.
I'm hoping that it's good.
Okay.
Are we counting these by hand?
Oh, gosh, no. We hope not to be. That's another thing, and I'd like to bring it up maybe tonight with Mary sitting here, is the ballot box is no longer being updated or serviced or maintained or whatever, if you will. It's kind of on the extinct list. I don't know how often they go on the extinct list, but I was wondering, Mary, how long do you think we've had this machine? Do you know what the life is, 10 years or 15 years? Or?
I think it's 11 years, because it was the second year that I was here that we got it.
Okay.
Yeah, it's served us well, but it's probably time.
Should it be going to the historical?
This year it's going to get it's
our other ballot
it's workout.
There.
Yeah.
So
I'm thinking just as an anticipated cost, maybe in the following year when we don't have a big election or something, that maybe we can visit.
And that would come ballot through a town clerk expense line item? Is that where that would
I would
show
hope
up
so. Or? I really don't have any idea how much they
so
cost.
So here's my question. We're going to have five different ballots?
Yep, you heard it.
Are you going to be able to take five different ballots and push them through that machine at the same time? Okay.
You can only have one ballot. Yeah. You have to choose between four ballots. You're going to have two ballots, the town ballot, and then one primary. You can only pick one ballot, but there are four choices.
I can only have two, but take 10 of us, there are five different ballots.
Correct.
So when you slide it into the machine,
correct,
it knows that it was different from the ballot that came just before it.
Correct.
Or the ballot that I'm going to put in second.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And it will tally them.
We're certainly hoping so.
Okay.
Yes.
All right.
The only reason I have a smirk on my face is as much as you try to be prepared for these kind of things, and that's the only thing that puts me at ease about anything is being prepared, is that I found out a couple days ago that the ballots that we received are being replaced. And so they're just arriving today and tomorrow. So, less than a week before the elections, we're getting new ballots.
Talk to Mary, because I'm sure Mary has counted ballots plenty of times.
Well, what happens is you actually I run them through a test. So I've already tested the old ballots, but I'm going to I invited Mary to join me tomorrow, and we're going to test whatever new ballots I have here today. So anyway.
Okay.
As you can see, Dylan, it's very much still in the air at this point.
So you're not budgeting to replace this machine next year?
In 17, I wasn't going to.
I mean, if that's when all the work is, it would seem like it might make some sense.
Well, I just found out that they're not. That they're not servicing them anymore. I just found out a couple of weeks ago. So, they'll service it, but they're not doing any updates and that kind of thing. But,
have they given you?
I think
any,
it's a sales pitch.
Yeah, definitely. Have they shown you any new machines that have been accepted by the state?
I haven't looked at any machines. I was in Devon's, and I found out actually from the other clerks that those are not. Mm. Those are on the extinct list.
Okay. The one thing that's jumping out at me is just the for the elections line item.
Mm-hmm.
I know it's a lot of work, and very much I'm open to additional work from you. When going from two elections to three, you know, the numbers more than doubling. That's just the one that.
Right. From last
maybe I'm
year.
Missing something.
Let me just see.
The presidential is in there.
And maybe that's,
and that's
well,
the big
it, maybe
one.
That's yeah. that much more than the other ones. That's, mm-hmm. I guess, just what I'm looking
yeah.
to.
Yep.
All right.
Let's see.
It's going to be an active year.
Yes.
Yeah, it's impossible to tell how accurate I was this year. I mean, I've only spent $400 out of the election budget so far because I haven't really done any yet. So, but whatever an election is, it is. I mean, if it's a little busier, your costs for workers will be a little bit more, but it doesn't really matter if it's a town election or a state election. The state election, the programming is paid for by the state anyway, so it's just as costly. They pay for the ballots, so I don't know.
And then the federal one, how is that compared to state or national? Whatever.
Correct. Well, I think we're expecting record numbers, so you have to order that many more ballots and that many more people.
Does the state pay for those?
Yeah, they do. They pay for the programming of the cards, and then they actually reimburse you for the couple hours or something that you have to open earlier than you would normally open if it was a town election.
So let's say that the election next November does cost $8,000, the additional amount, then we would be reimbursed for at least some, if not most, of that money anyway?
Well, not most.
Okay.
Yeah. Just for the 2 hours.
It's not very much. Yeah. It's not very much.
Normally, our elections open at 10, and these open at 7, so they pay for the extra 3 hours.
I see.
The other thing is there's a lot of new election things coming out like early voting. And at the time when I put this together, and even now, I really don't have any details on what that requires or what that's going to entail. I mean, there was talk at some point where we were going to have someone manning a booth, and that we were going to have to, you know, do all these things. But the sounds of it, although they still haven't outlined exactly what's involved, it sounds like it will happen within hours of business, but I don't know for sure. I don't know that it won't entail increased staff outside of just elections.
Okay. And then away from that line item, how have some of these other line items been going in terms of the budget versus the expenses 6 months in or in FY15 as you looked at them?
Right.
You know, just our continuing effort to try to get each line item as close to home as we can.
Yeah, yeah. No, I believe so. Nothing has changed all that much on the town clerk end. I asked LHS for a history of my cost and, you know, maybe came up with a $200 difference. So I don't anticipate a big change in anything in this budget other than the voting.
And then the last line item, the 800 dropping off, that is because they're no longer servicing the voting. Is that what that is, or that's something else?
Yeah, I think we haven't been utilizing it, and so I think we're thinking of going in another direction and just decided to contacted him, and you know we're paid through September, but we're not obligated to any further, you know, contract or anything like that. So
okay.
I do think we need to have some sort of records management or some sort of system in place. And I think that's what the thought was behind that system there, where we could scan and that kind of thing. But we honestly just, no one ever does it, and we can't get the history in there. And I don't know. It just wasn't working.
Okay. Do you have any other comments on what you'd like to do or what you do see us trying to go towards on that front?
Me too.
You're glad I asked, huh?
That was a good segue. Thank you, Dylan.
You're welcome.
I do. I kind of feel strongly about this, so I might have talked to one or more of you about it. But I feel like as a town, as multi-department people, that we would be benefit from getting some sort of organization of what we have for records, where they are, who's in charge of them, when the retention schedule applies, and that kind of thing. So I ran into a representative from a company that does such a thing, and they offer a broad range of services. They can come in and just organize your paper items, or they can take it a step further and do some scanning of your records. But these people do just municipal government jobs. So they know when they look at a piece of paper, what is this? They know the retention schedule. And actually, Dedek is having them do a project for them currently. And Montague, I was kind of following Montague because they just started a project, and well, when I started following her, and they just finished it. So I went up there last week, and I thought if I gave you some pictures, it would help you visualize what I'm talking about. So what they do is they actually go through every piece of paper that every town department has in a cabinet, on a table, stacked on top of a refrigerator or whatever. And they kind of map it all out, put it all in boxes, and then they label it all, when you can get rid of it, what's in there, and then they map out, you know, the areas. I went to Montague, as I said, and they have, they're probably double the project that this place would be. They must have six different offices with these stacks of boxes. But then everyone knows, if you need a zoning decision that was done, whatever, or you need a highway map that I'm trying to think of what you might need. But anyone would be, so they would train all employees to know where everything is, and they would follow up year after year to keep you in sync until you know where to file things, how to get rid of things, and that. Anyway.
So let me ask a question.
Yeah.
Are we having problems with this?
Am I having problems with this?
Yeah. We can't find things? We don't know where to...
I think so, yes.
So I can't say if it ain't fixed. If it ain't broke, don't fix
it's,
it.
No, it's
broke.
It's a problem.
It be broke.
It's a problem. And not only not finding things, but we're trying to work efficiently without any added staff or that. And what I can say is we spend a lot of time, someone will come in and say, you know, when was such and such a road discontinued? And now we're flipping through town meeting books. If, you know, hopefully they can narrow us down to a time where it might have happened. And we're literally reading town meeting minutes because they're, I think we would benefit from having a scanning project component of that job. We don't have any way to search other than manually reading the books, the meeting
so
books.
So, for example, using that, when was road XYZ discontinued?
Yeah.
If it was, how would you ever find it in any event?
Right. Well, if they scan the records, you would say whatever road, and you would have.
So it'd be digital. You could put in.
I know that when we started with the garage committee, there had been work done a few years before or something.
Right.
And we wanted to get all that data to start with, and that was a big job.
Yeah.
And you wound up with a few boxes of miscellaneous whatever.
Yeah,
find
it's
the boxes
time
and sort
or
it out, and
not knowing if you can respond to a request or your own request if you need something. Mm-hmm. Kevin came the other day and asked me to look up something that was voted in the 70s. So the two of us are reading through the book, and we finally found it. And all it said is they accepted the plan or whatever it was, but it didn't say what the plan was. So then we were trying to find something that gave us some substance, and I said, okay, it's been an hour. I don't know what our two salaries are together, but we haven't found anything. I don't know if it might not even be here. You know, sometimes you're looking for things that might not even be there. I would love it if someone, I don't know, looked into that or if there's another idea, but I've talked to several people that have worked with this company, and Deb up in Montague welcomes anyone. I told her that I was going to talk to anyone who would listen about it, so it welcomes anyone to go up and take a look through. I mean, currently we have a trailer outside with sweat in there.
The services that Barb was talking about through King Information Systems is an overview and an assessment, and basically the creation of strategies to allow a greater organization. They don't sell a product necessarily. They don't sell technology. But what they do is provide a structure within which we could organize. They also provide leads, or they have a team that can help to assist in the organizational process. The assessment is actually fairly inexpensive. It's between $4,000 and $6,000 for a team of people to come in for several days or as long as it takes in order to create that structure, a full analysis of all the documents we have and what we're trying to do with it. The expensive part comes when you hire a team of people to come in and implement that structure.
Right.
To get
to do that.
To this
Yeah.
is somewhere between, what, $25,000 and $40,000?
I think I was told 2025.
2025 for Montague.
I mean, obviously they haven't done the assessment yet, but
right.
Montague spent like $40,000 for their project.
Did Montague do digital scanning
they
of those
done
old
any
documents?
Digital. No.
No. So that's just the physical organization.
Yeah. I have no idea what digital was.
Okay.
I know their presentation at DEDIC, it was pretty impressive. And the one comment I would make on it is that the more time that goes by, the more you lose, you know. I mean, it's so timely to do this thing as soon as you possibly can while people are still here that might recall, and before the records get more.
I think it's probably more apparent because, you know, many of us are new, and so maybe someone knew where they typically tuck that folder, but nobody, a lot of people that are here now don't.
Now, obviously, to the extent that we can cost effectively manage this process, I think it makes sense as an investment in town efficiency and really mitigation for things that might come up and answers we need to come up with.
Sure.
To the extent that it was not cost effective, would the town have its own resources to say, okay, as of July 1st, 2016, we are going to start logging, scanning, maintaining everything new from this day forth in a system that works for us?
No.
Obviously, we'd still...
No, the town doesn't have the resources to do that.
This is why she's not keeping the laser fiche, is because it was available to them, but nobody had time to do it.
Every once in a while, someone would go over there for a little bit and scan a couple documents, and then... Okay. I mean, these people would come in and get us at least to ground zero.
Okay,
but even if you did get people to scan things, you need a common core system. That's
right.
The problem. It's like in historical societies. I mean, you need that software so everything is done the same way. And you know,
they're not selling software, though.
No, but they provide.
I didn't imply that they were. I used that as a
or the digital. There might be a software comment. Component.
That's
not sure.
Yeah.
I guess my concern is if we don't have the ability to do that going forward now, after they come and go, then 6 months from then, how is anything new being done then?
Well, not at all. I just think that right now I put certain papers here. Mary might have put them elsewhere. So from here forward, I know where my files are. I just don't know where something might have been from 20 years ago. So they're not united. There's no system of united, and I might be asked for records that someone else is filing, and I have no way of knowing outside of asking, where do you guys keep, you know, this? It plays into a records request that I have or something. So.
And even if you have different departments that have different things and do some different things, there still should be a common system that
Correct.
You sort of follow.
And that's exactly
even though there's variations.
What they get you all organized, and then they teach everyone how to use that. So everyone's using the same filing system. Everyone's using the same storage policy.
Yeah, absolutely.
So right. What he said, like even for maybe 1 or 2 years, he encourages the town, because I asked him that. I said, okay, so now, you know, you find a box open and someone was in there and they didn't put it back or something, you know. So he said he encourages them to have like maybe a catch room for the first year or two, so they will come back and say, okay, so these are this and this is how, you know, to make sure that you keep using it. I don't want to have someone come in and just get us organized and leave, because that, you know, 2 years from now or 3 years from now, it ends up...
Well, that's my concern, that we end
Correct.
Up 3 years from now back where we started with some historical section of things that are organized better and maybe differently than what goes on the follow if we don't maintain it, because then we're right back where we started.
No,
and then
yes.
This ends up just being an expense and not an investment. And that's
right.
I'm very interested in pursuing this, but that's right. Kind of where my concern comes
yeah,
from.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I said. So how do we
that's
know what to do?
That's where the manager's responsibility is spelled out and laid out and held accountable.
Well, you're absolutely right.
It is.
And Barb and I have talked about investing in this kind of organizational starting point, if you will, and we both have agreed that if this is what the town is going to move forward with, then there has to be buy-in by everybody, at least within town hall structure, from the inspections office all the way around the hallway.
Correct.
Here, so.
Yeah.
Which is why we're pursuing it carefully.
Right. And they map it all out. I mean, it's a system where you can refer to, okay, you know, section 12, you know, row 3, this is where these documents are contained. So going forward, that's where you're going to go with those documents to store them in the future.
I have one question.
Yeah.
We have no place to store things. Where would you put this?
Honestly, you know what? Deb said she found up in Montague that they ended up getting rid of a lot of things, where they found that maybe... the assessor and the treasurer both were keeping the same records, or you know, there was double and triple records that didn't need to be kept, or things that no longer needed to be retained that were being retained. She said, you know, they had piles and piles, and she said you had to kind of scooch in to get in between, just papers on tables, and they just found that once they went through everything, kept what they needed to keep, got rid of what they didn't need. That
and storage room.
Yeah, I mean, we have it somewhere now, you know. It's here now.
Yeah.
It's just we want to get it so we know where it is.
Right.
One of the things that I would like to see is, I guess, a list, for lack of a better term, of the stuff that we need to retain and for how long.
Oh, we have it. It's a manual.
It's mandated
it's difficult,
by the state.
And they're supposed to be rewriting it. Unfortunately, they did a presentation, and it doesn't look any greatly improved, so.
The retention schedule is published by the state. It's mm-hmm. different from, depending on the type of document mm-hmm. you're trying to, that you're looking at, it's a different retention schedule. Some things you keep for a year. Some things you keep for 6 years after the last payment of a given contract. Some things, like, for example, building inspection records, you keep in perpetuity mm-hmm. forever.
But you also have to have the physical record at that point, too, right?
Everything has to be a physical record, sure, yeah. absolutely.
And you can have digital, but if somebody actually needs to go to a physical record, they need to be able to.
They are now incorporating in a feature that you can keep an electronic version with something. So they are updating right. the retention schedule, yeah. which has been, it's pretty old.
But having been in the medical diagnostic business, we had very strict rules all under ISO 9000 sure. about that, and everything was very detailed, exactly what you save and how you save it and how
right.
long. And
mm-hmm.
you know.
Mm-hmm. One of the benefits, I think, is you indicated that Montague was able to or did get rid of lots of stuff. I think mm-hmm. most of us tend to say, what do I do with this? Well, I don't know. I'm going to file it.
Keep it. Exactly.
And it's... Yeah. You know,
and you forget where you filed it.
Yeah. It was nice for the meeting, but
right.
after the meeting's over, we don't need it.
Right. Yeah. That was their comments anyway.
So you're looking for somebody to drive this notion.
I'm happy to. We didn't really know where the project mm-hmm. belonged. I don't know really where the project belonged. You were talking about having it in contracted services,
I know he
had spoke about it at one point, but I just figured I would speak up since I was the one that had met him and experienced, you know, what right. the project's all about, and I was kind of the one pushing it, so.
Okay.
I'll leave to the board, I guess. So.
I think it's something we certainly are all very open to hearing more about.
Mm-hmm. And they can tailor the cost. They can, you know, kind of do the assessment one fiscal year and maybe, you know, part of the project and maybe the digital the next year if that's what we choose to do. But they can at least do the assessment, figure out what it is they would recommend and what we would be interested
could,
in.
Could we,
comfortable
I was going
with.
To say, if this ends up being a 2 or 3 year project,
I don't know.
Which it might.
It's possible. They could do it that
can,
way if you wanted.
Before we say, all right, let's do it, can we get into, do we get something that says this is what it's going to cost you to get from start to finish.
Mm-hmm. In order to do that, we have to have that assessment where they come in and spend several days, and that would be an initial $5,000 or $6,000.
It's somewhere between $4,500 and $6,000, depending on the scope and how much yeah. they've got.
How much time
that.
And whatever yeah. it takes for them to do that.
If we put off the physical work, never mind the digitization, but the physical work for too long, then we waste the assessment.
Yeah.
Right.
They have to come back
yeah,
and they have
can't
to
be
do
too
it again.
They yeah. can't be too
so
spread apart.
Right. It, you know, that in talking with Barbara, I was hoping to find the money in contracted services this year. Mm. And I've been looking very carefully at how much we've spent, what's left in that account, mm. and whether or not we can apply a portion of that to this. And if so, if we can finish this work within the next month or two, then maybe we could ask for an appropriation for next year, for FY17 to actually do the physical work.
And therefore, I relinquished my laserfish.
And therefore, maybe later on, we go for a digital solution for FY18.
Yeah, we just thought maybe there was a couple of things maybe we weren't using that had the same kind of mission, if you will, and that's where I came up with seeing if we could discontinue the laserfish.
Yep.
Okay.
Good.
Sorry, did you have something?
No.
I guess I'm, like I said, definitely want to hear more about it. I guess one other concern I'd have is just that there are the requirements and the historical documents in each town department are specific enough to that department that really the department head is going to have to kind of handle that, and it's not going to be something that's easily globally integrated.
Mm-hmm.
And to the extent that on the back end of it, then each department head is still just kind of managing what is under them, then I see less value in a larger global solution project. But I do want to hear more.
Mm-hmm.
That could be a very good question posed to the assessment team when they come in, though,
yeah.
or before they come in,
mm-hmm.
on how they would handle that.
I'm sure they run into it.
And what it would yeah. look like.
Because every department is different,
mm-hmm.
but there's commonalities to
yeah.
Actually,
like
in the initial
said,
presentation,
you know, town treasurer's account, tax collector accounts, a lot of them are the same as what the assessors have.
In the initial presentation by Chris, My understanding, correct me if I'm wrong, my impression was that they would go and look at every single department, mm-hmm. and their assessment would include everything, town clerk, mm-hmm. assessors, selectman's office, and inspections office.
Yep. DPW. Before primary,
you know, and they would provide a structure whereby all records, mm-hmm. regardless of where their source is, all records would be able to be stored.
No. Yeah, they could be mapped out. Doesn't mean they have to move to a central location.
No, right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Going back to what you referred to earlier, Dylan, this could be an investment for the town.
It could be, and that's why,
you know, being mm-hmm. much more efficient.
Okay. Any other questions on town clerk expense, which we still had that? It was $26,187 was the number, mm-hmm. With, you know, the increase for elections, with the extra election, the decrease in the maintenance line item that we discussed. Mm-hmm. I think all the others are the same. Yep.
Yeah.
I do have a question, if you want to call it that. Mm-hmm. In 2015, or if I look across at the expended figures, mm-hmm. they do vary a little bit. But going back to 2011, 12, 13, 14, 15, they range from 12,500 to 17,500.
Yeah, I don't have it that far back.
And last year, we voted $20,000, spent $13,000.
That was
15.
FY 15.
15 last year. Okay. This is 16, right?
Okay. Yep.
So there's 6,500 that was not spent. Which is nice. and somewhere along the way, there was a state election in 2015. We've had a governor's race
in November of that was it 15?
I think so. Mm-hmm. Took That's office.
There we go.
No, maybe it was 14.
November 14 was the
FY 15. FY 15, that would be fiscal. November 14. Yep. Right. Yes, it was a state election.
Okay.
So there had to have been fair turnout, at least in that. I don't remember what the numbers were. And we had town elections.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we're going to have a presidential election. Mm-hmm. More people, I agree.
Correct.
But we also, and that's going to be 2017, so we had it in 2013, and that was a big number. So the difference between 13 and 17 is we have one more election that, mm-hmm. and I would just.
Yeah, 13, 13 elections was 8,500, is that what you have?
We don't have it, we have the total.
No. Oh.
The total of 19,541.
Mm-hmm. Barb, how much has the minimum wage gone up?
Yeah,
that's another
one.
Well, that was a consideration. The thing I was wrestling with was the minimum wage and the early voting. And this election is going to mirror more like 2000 and not this last election, presidential, was not what we're going to see this time, probably, you know, yep. with Barack Obama. And so even elections, I have Harry Petrucci is our representative locally, and he had actually stopped by to just kind of walk through the elections with me. He said, because don't look at the last presidential election, because those are not the numbers you're going to need. That's not the staff you're going to need. It's not the amount of ballots you're going to need. It's not the anything you're going to need. You got to look back to the previous. So.
2008.
Yeah, 2008. Yeah. It could maybe settle to less than that, especially if the early voting doesn't entail extra hours in any way. I don't have any verification of that. But.
And, well, my concern is that mm-hmm. we have lots of demands on relatively resources that aren't expanded.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
So I do have a problem when a budget exceeds 2.5%.
Mm-hmm.
And I would rather somewhere along the way keep the budget constant and look at, you know, if we have to increase the Finance Committee's reserve account, whatever it's called, reserve fund.
Yep, keep it on the tight side, and then if you have to, that's fine.
Do that.
Mm-hmm. Yep, I'm just making my...
No, I appreciate that.
Best effort to recommend what I think is safe. Obviously, I was fluctuating a bit on the elections component part of it and gave up the laser fiche. I don't think we're using it. There's, as far as I know, expenditure-wise, this particular year, I think we... Last year, the timing was strange or something with our bylaw submittal and when it went to code. So that line item didn't get expended out of 15. My fiscal year is messed up. But fell on 16. So I could be in trouble this year in 16 if I have to do another code update because it didn't get paid out of 15. It got paid out of 16 immediately. So... just talking about line items and having money left, like 15 should have had at least probably 2,000 or more out of it for code updates that ended up getting spent out of 16.
Okay.
What are code updates?
Like when we vote at annual town meeting to change a bylaw, a zoning bylaw, and then I have to send it to the state, get the approval from the Attorney General, and then I can send it off to General Code to have our code books and the online updated. So it's just the timing of that bill came into the next fiscal year. So
okay.
And it probably will this year too, right?
I hope so, because last year's was in this year, so.
No, I mean, what
but I'm just explaining why sometimes like 15, it didn't, it should have had another $2,000 in there.
Yeah.
Okay. I would generally echo Skip's comments. I think it is, and no reflection on you and the job you're doing, I think.
I don't
doing
take
a
that
great
way.
Job, and I think that you're approaching this in a very good way. It is challenging for us. We see a lot of budgets that are higher, and as we get a clear sense of the overall budget picture, I think it's going to paint a somewhat difficult one. We'll see how difficult. I guess I'd open it back up to the committee here. In other budgets where we kind of felt like this, we may have to revisit later. We have voted them, and with the understanding that if we get a little further down the road, we may have to, you know, have a call or have you back in or discuss it again. How do people feel about going that route, or do we want to try to amend this budget as it currently stands? I am open, honestly, to either path that you guys would like to pursue.
Can I say something?
Sure.
I would be fairly comfortable if you went back to the 23,187. I wrestled between the two, and the more information I get, the early voting doesn't sound like it's going to require additional outside of the regular course of business hours. So my earlier
estimate.
So that would be 11,877 for elections. For a total of 23,187.
Yep.
Bottom line.
Yep.
You'd be okay with that?
Yeah, as long as they're okay with if I run short and appear before them.
If you run short, then you're gonna have to come.
That's fine.
We understand that your first estimate was not a lowball estimate. That was your estimate. So very much understand that. And you know, if we didn't think we were going to be having these conversations with many departments, we wouldn't be having it with you either.
Yeah. So. No, I appreciate the collaboration.
Yeah.
Doug, that number 11, what was it?
Take 3,000 off it.
Okay.
11,877.
Yep.
Thank you.
Yep. For a total of 23,187 at the bottom line.
Okay. You know, I thank you for that. That's great. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we'll certainly be in touch as this comes together of where we end up. And if we end up with extra room or not enough room, we may be having the same conversation, but we appreciate your willingness to work with us from the outside. With that, I would, unless there's any other discussion, I would entertain a motion for the amended amount of 23,187.
Make the motion.
And seconded, did I hear?
Yeah. Yep.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Okay.
Cool.
Okay. Moving on to the treasurer's expense. I believe is the next one.
Okay. And what is the account number on that one? Oh, there we go. It's 145.
Yeah.
145.
I don't know that I have a copy of that somehow. Nope.
You need a copy?
Pulled out.
I guess I do.
Yeah,
that's
what's on the other side?
The other side is treasurer collector benefits.
just go and keep going.
There.
Yep.
Okay. let's see. Pushed, I don't know what that means. So what do you have? 35801?
Yes.
I don't know where it is.
Is that
on there or no?
No,
it's right here.
140,
yeah.
I can't line it.
Oh, it's just like.
Oh, maybe I wrote it in here.
Yeah, I'm not sure that makes sense. Looking this way, that way, maybe you don't.
I'm getting the same thing. Ill prepared on this one.
Okay.
unfortunately, I am not really sure where my details or anything is on this one.
Okay.
I have two town clerk ones.
I'd feel most comfortable just passing over an entire. No, don't apologize. We can certainly follow up. That's why we're trying to start as early as we can this year in the cycle, so we have time if this happens.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so we're going to pass over that. Okay. And pick that up another time.
What did I have?
So the next one is the salaries. Is that
the benefits?
The next one we're doing.
Yeah, clerk, treasurer, collector salaries. I believe would be next.
The salaries or the
The benefits salaries. Are just the the hypothetical.
All right, I apologize.
Not a problem.
That.
You've been doing great, so
we've
gotten through like eight of them.
Yeah,
sorry.
There's a lot there.
Yeah.
You're batting like 900. That's still good.
I thought I started at the tough ones and thought I would work back to the easy ones. So we're doing salaries?
Sure.
So we have it all in one now rather than we used to have it separate into two different ones. So is that what you're looking at?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Do you have 150?
153, 158.
158, okay, perfect. Because when I went to print one, I didn't have the other thing. So there's no surprises in here. I think the only thing I did add was a $500 education bonus for the assistant treasurer. That is being proposed in new legislation, and if it gets approved next year, and she is testing next year, I'd love for her to be eligible for it. It's an education bonus for getting certified as a treasurer from the Mass Treasurer Collectors Association. We go to schooling. It takes generally 3 years if you take a full courses and then you test.
Okay. I think that makes sense to have
The treasurers and collectors have had that as $1,000, but they're proposing that assistants that successfully, they take the same exam, so that the Mass Journal Law would allow for a $500 education bonus. So if that does get approved, it has not been approved yet, hasn't been signed yet, but if it does, and she passes, I was hoping it would be in there for her. And
is she in her third year?
I'm sorry?
Sarah in her third year of
Yeah, these classes will be her third year, so she'll take her third year classes and test right away. Other than that, I think what are we doing, 1.7 on the grade 10 people,
that's,
I believe?
Yeah, that's a placeholder for yep. now, but yeah.
So that's what you see there with
the
step 10
just,
plus.
And then the other two are just up one step.
Yep.
And then the other couple items here, the Chapter 41 and the consulting training, I see those are in there last year as well.
Yeah, the Chapter 41 is what I was just talking about.
Oh, I'm sorry.
$1,000 bonus. No, that's okay.
I thought you were talking about the assistant treasurer education bonus of $500.
Yeah, and then that's the second one, so that's new.
Okay.
We hadn't had that before. I've been weaning off the consulting and training, but in the event that I have Mary come in or Mary come in and cover, or I have somebody else come help me with something, mm-hmm. Just so I have some sort of way to pay them.
Take them to lunch.
Yeah. The other thing, I just wanted to mention one more thing when I was doing the town clerk budget. I know you already voted it. But the other thing that they that I know they're going to require with the early voting is a training component. So I have to be able to pay for the poll workers to go to training. Everyone has to have training. Anyway, I just thought of that, and I didn't mention it before.
Mm-hmm. And that would be picked up through this line item or back through the expense?
No, back.
It would be in the town clerk budget. But anyway.
Barb, the chapter and verse that you cite, Chapter 41, Section 108P, does that apply to both treasurer and assistant treasurer?
They haven't approved the assistant yet. So
that's going to be something else.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't know what they'll number it.
So just so I can be a little smarter on this, so
sure.
For the assistant treasurer going through the education, if they pass the testing, and then it'd be eligible for the salary increase would be?
It's a $500
stipend.
Right.
You voted at town meeting, though.
They would have to vote it at town meeting?
Yeah. That's what we had to do for the 1,000.
Oh, yeah.
Accept the provisions.
Right.
To accept the provisions.
Or at a special town meeting, could they?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's the new one, and that's the 500 that's just
right.
new this year. And then the 1,000 one is...
Has always been there.
Has always been there.
That's me, because I passed my test.
Okay, so same thing for the non-assistant.
Right.
The treasurer.
The treasurer and collectors have had that
on
the books, and now they're just proposing to add the assistance in some way for the same thing.
Now I understand.
Okay.
So moved.
Okay, second?
I'll second that.
All right, so this is, Doug, do you have the same thing, 153, 158?
That's what I have.
Yep.
All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Everyone?
I will say that I don't know what you have. What do you have for the treasurer's budget? 28-something? It was 28 last year.
Yeah, it was deleted this year.
It was deleted?
Yeah.
Sorry, what
go home.
They didn't tell you.
I believe the only change I made was to add the OPEB report, the GASB 45.
I'm sorry, which budget are we talking about?
The one we passed, the treasurer. I'll tell you
expense.
The number.
Expense?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. We passed over that.
So I don't have it in front of me, but I believe last year was like 28 something, and this year is like maybe 35 or something.
It was 28, 450.
Yes.
And so that is the only difference.
Is what, I'm sorry?
The we have to do our GASB 45 or 65 or 78 or whatever. Every 3 years you do it. And so it's in the fiscal year 17 budget.
Okay. Yes, I see it in the 14 budget broken out, it seems.
It's just coming to me what I had in there.
No, it looks like we budgeted 8,000 in 2014.
But that was the first one, and we didn't know how much it was going to be. We didn't know who we were going to hire. But I know. I already asked him, and he told me whatever I wrote down there. 58 today?
It's not broken out.
Did we vote this, or we put it aside or something?
We held it because
it's just coming to me now,
yes.
Skip, what I had in my budget.
Right.
Even though I don't have it in front of me, I know that the only difference was the GASB 45 report that we need to do.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I mean, the notes on here say 5,000 on recap sheet for tax title.
Right.
Proposed tax sale for FY16 added 2,500 mm-hmm. and removed $1,080 for tax file conversion no longer necessary with new software.
That was last year's notes, honestly.
Year's okay.
Note. Yeah. Well, that's okay. What happened is we're allowed on our, what do you call it? Not Schedule A. Oh, my gosh. This is what happens when it's late. Anyway, on a recap sheet.
There we go.
On our recap sheet, we're allowed to kind of like appropriate tax title funds. And so that's what I did the last couple years. So I lowered the tax title line item in that budget. That's what that was saying, because I had it on the recap sheet.
And this year you lowered it again to 2,500, it looks like.
Yes. Yep.
Okay.
We'll put a little more on the recap sheet.
No problem. All right. Well, once we have kind of the details updated, and as you said, most of it's going to have to do with this GASB three-year line
that
item.
That was the,
I think we'll, I don't think we're going to need you to come back in for that. We can, I can email and we can talk about it and go from there.
Yeah. Because his, I saw his total and I'm like, why is it so much more? I was trying to remember, but
okay.
That's what it was.
Okay. What else you got? Is that
I've got one.
Okay.
Out of care.
Yeah, that was on the back. We didn't do that one.
It was on the back of something. It was on the back of group insurance. We didn't cover it.
We skipped something?
We skipped.
I think we did.
Oh. Oh, you know what? Did we talk about veterans?
Like veterans?
That we did.
I think we voted that before. Didn't
I think Medicare insurance is the only one that we did not do.
Wait, are you talking about veterans benefits?
9/16.
When did you vote that?
It's on the back side.
I don't know that we did. 9/14. I have it still out here.
Another week. Another week.
Wasn't that one of those that we had, the veterans benefits, wasn't that one of those?
We did two.
So there was the benefits we voted, and then the district assessment was one we held for you to verify the number, then we voted the following week.
The veterans we did? I don't remember.
Was it 35,000?
We didn't do it.
Okay, 35,000. That's perfect.
We didn't do it tonight. We did it a couple weeks ago.
Oh, okay, perfect.
Yeah.
We had the
9th?
What's that?
Was it the 9th?
What?
No, voted? I think it was earlier. I think it was the first. I think it was the first one.
Second week. Because the first week we
Medicare again is a percentage of payroll. So
I've got all that information at home.
Yeah, I mean we have it in our minutes. I just don't have it on me. Yep.
Do we have Medicare outstanding to talk about?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. I gotta find it.
Yeah.
9/16, 5,400. 9/16.
My numbers are reversed here.
Oh.
Okay, Medicare insurance, I see a number, a net number of 78,047.
Right.
With a gross of 88,770.
Is that what you have?
I have 88,770 for the total bill.
Because this is not the right one either.
I've got some adjusted offsets, though.
Yep.
The South County EMS, the offset is 9,084.
Now, is this, again, something that's coming from their budget, and should it be coming from their budget versus from Barbara's office?
Well, she's taking it from salaries.
That's pretty easy to calculate.
I know, but then why is it, why'd it change, I guess?
It is easy to calculate. I just, I don't want him to calculate it on his total budgeted payroll, which has in the past been higher than what was expended, so... I think that might have been an early one because I don't have that one.
The Medicare insurance?
Yeah.
The number that I've got for the offset, at least for South County EMS, I literally got today.
Oh, okay. So that's from them.
From his budget.
Right. That's from his budget.
Should it be coming from his budget? So no. Okay. Okay, but so let's talk about the gross number, the 88,770. We'll deal with the offsets later. We'll probably end up having to vote this later for that reason until we verify what those are. But if you just want to speak to the gross number.
Yeah, it's really just projected payroll. Typically, we look at payroll and figure like 2% just because everyone's getting little raises or whatever. And that's what we figure the payroll will be. And then it's
1.45%.
Yeah, so...
Okay.
So, out of curiosity, what would you say that the gross payroll for the town was?
Ooh, well, I know each one is just over 250 without EMS, so.
Just over 250, what do you mean?
250,000 gross payroll?
Yeah, 250,000 each.
Biweekly, 26 times.
Now, does that include schools and
It doesn't include EMS.
It just doesn't include, so $250,000 is what our biweekly payroll is.
Approximately.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Just for round numbers, yeah.
All right. I looked at it and I did the calculation and I came up with a $6.5 million gross, approximately.
Right. That's 250 by 26.
Yeah. $6.5 million out of.
And we've got a budget of $15 million. It's typically, I've always used the old 80-20 rule.
Mm-hmm.
It's less than 50% of the. I'm just a little surprised, I guess.
What's the $6.5 million figure?
Gross payroll for the town for the year.
Are you including the schools in that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, because we're paying if
right.
If we're paying 1.45%, approximately $6 million comes up to $80,000 to $90,000.
Correct. Because right, $500,000 12 times.
Mm-hmm. So the only thing on top of that would be the three department or any department being offset here. So
right.
South County.
But I'm taking the 88, the top number. It just seems low, I guess is what I'm saying.
It seems low, yeah.
And that's just, you know.
Well, let's see.
I mean, I would have said the gross payroll for the town would be probably closer to $10 million. And
oh, no.
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 Nope. Well, that's a spot check we can certainly do.
We're going to get this.
No, I just got it.
And actually, I just did. I know our Medicare expense is always 3,000 something, like 3,300 or 3,000 mm-hmm. something.
78,000 plus.
So you do that times 26, and it's 85.8. Sure. So. Yeah.
No, it's.
I think it's right.
I mean, how's it? I mean, looking in prior years, it seems like we're.
No, it's fine.
Yeah,
no, I was just surprised that you know when I made the calculation, like I said, I thought it should come out to about 10 million. It came out to about 6 million. It was like, wow.
Yeah.
It seems awfully low. So, salary, you got benefits you have to add on. The benefits add a third to that. Yeah. So, it's still that's about 8 million mm-hmm. on a $15 million budget. So, $7 million is non-salaried items.
Mm-hmm. If your salaries are $6 million, then your benefits are probably another two.
That's right. So and then $7 million of non-salary and benefited sure. items.
Well, look, group insurance. Look at that. That's $900,000.
That's yeah. a benefit. Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. It's another $1,000.
So we still have that
million. Yeah.
$7 million that we're spending.
Yeah, you've got $1.3 million in the benefits line item.
Skims.
Yeah. Throw some more in for other things that, you know, Medicare, for example.
Was there other things you wanted me to speak to?
We need to vote that.
I think we're going to pass on that for now because we need to get the offsets right. I think once we get those, it'll be a straightforward budget because mm-hmm. it seems to be in line. Is there any other budgets that you care to speak to or any other things that you'd like to speak to more generally to the budget process?
No. I think my only two items were the possible voting machine in the near future and the idea of having some sort of organizational system of some kind.
Okay. If obviously they won't cost the same thing and are very different things. If you can only have one of them, which would you rather have?
Oh. Jeez. Well, I certainly wouldn't want an election without the voting machine working, but the other I use on a day-to-day basis, so that's a tough one.
Okay. More concentrated risk versus
exactly.
a daily risk.
Call in sick that one voting day or
or close the shades on the right. office window.
Barbara?
Yes.
OPEB?
Yeah, you had asked me about a couple other topics. I don't know if you want to get into any of those. OPEB, I don't know whose budget that really is. I would assume it's a selectman's choice to fund it or not. I don't know. It'd be nice to.
It's your budget.
Make deposits. Is it my budget?
To the extent that the all the other stuff, you're going to have to invest the money at some point in time.
Right. I just I didn't know that I would be...
I would assume it would come out of...
Yeah, well, we've talked about different ways of getting deposits in there, whether we want to budget for an OPEB contribution every year, or...
So now just...
I don't know that that's my decision. I kind of felt like the selectmen were deciding what to do with that, but...
Okay. Well, I think we're just having a conversation.
Yeah.
So just to make sure we're all on the same page. So now, to the extent that you did not do anything with OPEB,
mm-hmm.
The unfunded liabilities would just continue to accrue on a cash basis each year to your budget.
Mm-hmm.
However, the risk being that the state says you need to do something quicker than letting that play out.
Mm-hmm.
Is that accurate?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I guess, and whatever reflection it has on us, on our bond rating and...
Sure. That being one of, I guess, the softer ways they could motivate
Correct.
Towns to...
Yeah.
Towns could be motivated to do something.
Correct. Whether we're... I don't know. I guess my opinion is whether we're motivated by the huge numbers that come across on our GASB 45 or not... I think it's undeniable that we should be kind of putting something aside for that liability, even if it was just marginal to the amount that the reports are reporting.
Mm-hmm.
I guess,
to the extent that you now last year we set up a revolving fund for this to sit in or special
Correct.
Revenue, I'm
a
not
trust
sure
or whatever
yeah. format. Now, to the extent that we put, let's say, $50,000 in there.
Yep.
So now, what is the plan of what would happen with that money? Because again, the next year there's an OPEB bill for that year's assessment, but that would go to the budget and the $50,000 would not be applied to that necessarily.
No, it's just a savings account. It's
sure.
not going to a bill of any kind.
Yeah. And so then what is the flexibility of what can be done with that money?
I think the idea is to be able to fund yourself going forward for all of your post-employee benefits.
Mm-hmm.
I guess they're saying if everybody just, you know, the cost of everybody as an employee going forward for group insurance and that kind of thing.
And living a long time.
Right, living a long time.
Yes. So. I understand. My biggest concern is... two,
mm-hmm.
I would really like to see a plan that says, look, here's what we're going to do.
Right.
We're going to put $2,500 into the account every year for the next, or mm-hmm. $2.5 million every year, whatever the number is.
Right.
And then I want to know how it's going to be invested and who's going to do that.
Mm-hmm.
I've got real concerns about having the town... No, not concerns about you,
no,
but
I don't
having
take it that
concerns
way.
About the town taking on that responsibility
mm-hmm.
of investing what's going to be a pretty large sum of money.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that's one of the discussion points as far as I'm concerned.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, that's been our history of investing our trust accounts that way.
But we really, how much do we have that we're investing? It's relatively small numbers of dollars.
Mm-hmm.
Which trusts are currently invested in that manner?
The Dickinson Library, what are some other names, Mary? This is what's the trouble.
Sorry, I didn't mean
with.
To put you on the spot.
No,
small,
it is late night, and I just get
a couple of small
stuff.
Funds related to cemetery maintenance, I think.
Okay.
Brookside Cemetery, there's a land preservation.
Yeah.
Stabilization. Mm-hmm.
Used to
so
have
the,
others.
So the town stabilization fund is fairly freely investable into capital markets?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
very
not
conservatively.
Yes, it is very conservatively.
Very conservatively.
Yeah. And what does that mean? If
it means it earns a very, very low rate of interest, but it's put at a very, very low amount of risk.
Okay.
The state creates a list that we have to go by.
Okay, well, I think I also share the concerns of wanting to know kind of what the parameters of that would be.
Yeah.
Is there going to be another... update of the OPEB report. I don't recall when that was last done.
That's what I was talking about.
That's what's going to be done this year.
FY17, yeah.
So it's going to be done during FY17. That's correct. Going to be alignment in that budget. Because,
yes.
You know, that to me is going to make it tough for me and whatever my opinion matters on this to advocate putting money in before we see exactly what that report's going to say. I know we have one from
the
past.
I was going to say, I don't think it's going to go down.
The other problem that I had with the last report, as I understood it, was it contemplated a scenario whereby the town never hired another employee. And I know that's not going to be the case, so it got very difficult for me to size a strategy around a state of the world that wasn't literally possible to exist.
And I couldn't figure out what the strategy was, so you were further along than I was.
Yeah.
And that was outlined in there, that it's a static number?
It seemed to me, and again, I'm very open to getting smarter about this. I spent a fair amount of time on it a year ago or so when we first started talking about it. Yeah. I've not spent a lot of time in this budget season on it, but definitely want to return to it, especially if we're going to be moving down a path of doing something in FY17 regarding OPEB. That said, I do agree this isn't something that can be perpetually ignored.
Right.
I think, like a number of things that we've talked about this year, FY17 and the budget discussions leading up to town meeting this year may be more about the planning and the strategy of what we want to accomplish that then will hopefully show up in the FY18 budgets as implementable plans.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We see that in a number of places here, and I think it's very important that we do that.
Yeah, yep. It'd be great. And I think really it would help us to have a plan, you know, even if the investment is minimal. I guess my part of OPEB is just communicating to you what I'm understanding on my end. So I just want to let you know whether I don't know if I'm the person to fund it, but I was just saying I feel like I am the one that has that information, and I just want to bring it to all of you, and that's what they're looking for, bond rating wise or whatever. Not necessarily huge deposits in a growing, I mean, that would be great, but at least steps forward, you know, creating a trust, having a policy, having a funding policy. Any of those things. And so I think we could work on that, you know, and even if our deposits were only small.
I think we need to find out what the select board's role is in this.
Sure.
You know, I just want to make sure that everybody's on the same page.
Yep.
And if we're going to be talking about policy and planning.
Correct.
And so on and so forth.
Those are the components they're looking for. The trust account to be made, an investment policy, a funding policy, and then obviously funding.
Yeah, because, you know, this is too big. You know, this isn't in the same conversation as, you know, printer toner and
That's why I say I don't know that I would have it in my
car
budget.
Insurance. This is about, okay, let's look at the horizon of the town garage debt maturity schedule and the pension, when that unfunded liability is going to drop off in 2030, whatever. Mm-hmm. And where do we find a pocket of time and budgets that we can start to dedicate or plan for this to fall into?
Mm-hmm.
Whether it's small amounts over time or a larger funded amount at one point, you know, that's where we need to start planning this stuff out, which is really on the town side of things, not even, and then there's separately in the OPEB side of things, better understanding what that report is telling us and what it means for us down the road.
Yep.
So, okay. And I guess one other thing I'd love your thoughts on is, as we've seen and talked about a handful of these budgets that have the benefits broken out, not explicitly like wastewater and South County, but starting to do it for all of them. Do you find that to be helpful? And then do you see any potential problems to going down that path and making that more explicit potentially in future years?
I do. I struggle with the advantage of putting it there like that, because that number isn't a number of any kind or sort. It's an average of what someone might take. They might take more than that. They might take less than that. That person might not take any group insurance at all. So I had actually talked to Doug some time ago about
a month and a half,
and I had shared my thoughts on that.
Yep.
I have a couple problems, I guess struggles with it, and I also don't see a whole lot of positive to handling it, at least that way.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that
the departments are small, and I'm afraid of breaking it out to the degree of a department, and I just feel like I give up people's privacies and perhaps violate HIPAA laws. I don't know, but
absolutely,
I would like,
we have to handle those. Those are everybody's top concern, is
correct.
To not only follow HIPAA laws, but to protect.
So to not be able to put the right number in the department, but to put just an average number, I don't know. I think that, I don't know, things are just confusing enough already.
So what about putting correct numbers for budgets or for departments that are large enough that you have obscured any individual information?
And I would just like to understand what the benefit to that was. I would like to make the benefits clearer, understood in general, because it can change. A department, they can, you know, open enrollment, they can switch to, someone will have a baby, now they're on a family plan, they used to be on a thing plan, so then that changes, and I don't know that I see the advantage to tracking it in that particular way. What I was thinking would be helpful is if, actually I outlined it, is if I prepared, and actually you were asking, and I have it here after all, what all the group plans cost. So I thought maybe if I gave the hiring authority, like the people at the school and the selectmen, what I would say as a Deerfield benefit package, like here is what, if you consider hiring an employee at $40,000, just take a look, you might end up spending, you know, the town cost per month could be $1,100.
Mm-hmm.
Or whatever. So however they want to choose it, so that it's obvious, in addition to the salary, what else they would possibly be taking on, and retirement and the contribution to life insurance, which is kind of minimum. But I think that's what you're trying to say, is the hiring authorities need to realize what the salary and the benefits cost.
Yes.
I don't know.
Yeah, I guess I'll express my take. Mm-hmm. I don't care. Take any department.
Yeah.
They budget for the salaries of the employees.
Right.
And if you're going to add an employee, mm-hmm. then you have to budget for that.
Right.
And if there's a clothing allowance, that's put in the budget.
Mm-hmm.
And all of those other things that go in. So if you're going to do all that,
mm-hmm.
my argument is mm-hmm. that the benefit costs ought to be in there. I mean, if we're not going to do all that, then why don't we just have one massive budget in the town that says, here are the employees, and it's going to cost us $6.5 million.
Right.
Let's go with that.
But everyone doesn't get a clothing allowance. One department.
No. All I'm saying is, if you're going to go to the extent of mm-hmm. putting all of these pieces into a budget for the police department, for the highway department, mm-hmm. for a wastewater treatment plant, for South County EMS, then why not?
Well, just the wastewater and EMS.
Well, no.
And
look,
South County.
I'm saying if you're going to go to the point of having a separate budget for all of these departments,
mm-hmm.
where you have the salaries, salary for the police department, that's in the budget.
Mm-hmm.
It's the chief's responsibility to manage that budget and those salary items.
Right. But once you take on the employee, how can you manage the insurance benefit? It's already promised. It's already a liability.
Well, there, I guess
once
there's
you hire
the salary,
them.
When you hire them.
I think there's two.
The selectmen hire. The department heads don't hire. The selectmen hire. And at that point, when they make the decision to hire somebody, it's over.
If I can make a comment, I think that there's two aspects to this that I think each of you are talking about. I think you agree fairly well that there is the aspect of, let's use health insurance as an example,
mm-hmm.
someone getting hired and taking it versus not taking it, or being on individual, then having something that the mm-hmm. individual employee that's already been hired and budgeted, however they've been budgeted, are changing their benefit options within the scope of the benefit package they're offered. And if you looked at that department's budget year over year, as those things happened, it might be fluctuating in ways that no department head could actually manage.
Correct.
Right.
And I think that may be Barbara's point.
That's what I'm trying to say.
It's difficult. I think Skip's point, and this is one that I share as well, let's say you have a department with five employees who all have family plans and stay on family plans for 10 years over the scope of whatever we're going to look at. The concern that I have, and I actually had a conversation with someone within the town who said, okay, but if you do that, if you put the benefits, the health insurance benefits of those employees on that department,
right,
if the cost of health insurance goes up by 5% a year, how am I ever going to run a budget? That'll, you know, and it's like, okay, but how's the town going to, like, if that's a problem for you, imagine that is our problem. It needs to be both of our problems.
And that's exactly what I'm saying. It's already the town's liability.
But the problem is that I think we also do need to make sure that departments have that same, are bearing that same cost. Because the problem is, let's say you have a year where health insurance costs go up by a lot, and now there's a large squeeze on the budget that is being felt by the town portion of group insurance.
Sure.
And now you have all the departments that are looking for whatever, flat budgets, up 1%, whatever, but there's a lot less money to start with. And they just don't see it on their budget because it's not part of their budget.
Well, I think rightly so. I think what happens with the individual departments is they're worried about their own budget. So they're focused on their own cost without realizing that there's additional cost, residual cost to what they're doing. And what happens is it increases the town budget. So when we get to the point, and I realize what you're saying, but when we get to this point where all of a sudden, well, they've got their budget and that's what they're concerned about and they want to get that passed, which is understandable, but they're not keeping in mind that the town also has a budget that they have to run, and our revenue, if we don't have any new growth in revenue, where does money come from? And I think people are struggling with that. And so I think the attempt here was just to show a true reflection on the actual cost and what the town is up against.
Right.
I don't think a lot of people consider that and realize that when you're talking, you know, when they talk about their salary schedules and so on and so forth, they don't realize that you have another $800,000 over here or 800 plus in benefits, you know? And I mean, that's... So that does have an impact, and I think everybody needs to be more aware of that, and I think it's an issue of bringing awareness to everybody.
I don't know how to do that.
And I'm not saying it's your job to do that.
Well, it would fall on me, I'm sure, to dissect this to that degree. Just makes my hands sweat, really. I just worry about sharing people's information. I worry about departments saying, geez, you know, I'd rather have this guy working because he's cheaper than that guy working. Or, you know, I just feel like there's a lot of things that are cost of doing business. The electricity, the property insurance takes a hike, and then that puts a pressure on all the budgets. That's how it works. The budgets get pressure from all over.
I think this is a big enough line item, though, that's why it's a little bit of a different conversation. And I agree with you on being cautious about giving up anybody's information. And I also agree with you on this risk of the first case I articulated with you of people like changing their insurance and that changing cost. That's why I do think using an average is a interesting concept, because at the end of the year, due to changes like that, there's going to be an actual cost that's going to be different from your estimation every year. Higher, lower, we don't know, but it's going to change even if you know all the employees and even if they all stay, just from people rolling into and out of and changing plans. So in using an average, that residual slippage, if you want to call it that, of people changing plans is going to fall back on the town, because that's going to change your actual number versus your estimate. And by allocating out an average to everybody, you're not penalizing someone for hiring someone that goes on a family plan or rewarding someone for hiring someone that's on an individual plan or gets their health insurance somewhere else.
Okay, but as it appearing next to someone's name with a number, it's confusing.
But you wouldn't have to do it by name. It'd be number of employees.
Well, that's how the budgets are right now.
It would be a line item for number of benefit eligible employees. It would be an average for employee for the town cost, and then a portion of however many employees that department has, it'd be the average times that many. You wouldn't have to do it per person.
I think what is important is that if you're going to hire a new person in your department, you need to have what the total cost of hiring that employee. Mm-hmm. That's where it really all comes down to, mm-hmm. that we need to know if we're going to hire somebody for $50,000 a year, we're going to be paying another $25,000 for benefits. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's the type of thing where this is really important. But as an overall thing, like Barb says, you're really, especially for the small departments, you're not getting a true picture there. Yes. Sorry.
Fourth time, I'll try.
Did you want to say something?
No. I was looking to adjourn.
We're not done yet.
I was joking. I understand your concern. I also understand the various comments here about the manager looking at their department and what their true cost is. And I agree with both of these things. But one thing that Jeff was saying was the word they. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if you're listening to the conversation, you would say they is the managers. But they, to me, are the citizens, the taxpayers. Mm-hmm. And that's my concern. I mean, the manager should say, what am I doing? Why am I here? What's my department about? Do they really need me or not? Should I be growing? Should I be shrinking? Mm-hmm. And, of course, people usually is a big chunk of an industry anyway, a big chunk of the cost. And I'm sure it's the same in the town, mm-hmm. although I've never run a town department. But the problem, I mean, they should be looking at it and thinking about that. But the other side of it is the taxpayer sees, okay, how many people do we have and what's the cost of those people? And grant you, there's another line item for benefits somewhere floating out there, but they don't hook it together. And I think it's really important that the townspeople know how many people in total we got mm-hmm. and how much the total is really costing. Because usually that's the big chunk of the total budget when you look at the whole thing altogether. And I think that's the danger of separating it out. That's my comment.
Great. I think the other thing to think about, too, is I guess I'm just having trouble picturing how this would be. And if each department budgeted for their own group insurance, is this what you're proposing?
No, you would give them an average cost estimate from the town, let's say, group insurance number, to use that line item. You would come up with the total limit, just like you do for South County EMS, like doing the same thing for other departments.
South County EMS, I do it policy by policy, and I add it all up.
Well, you can either do policy by policy, or you could do an average for the ones that are still within the town and the town hiring authority. I mean, again, those are details we can sort out, mm-hmm. but I think there is a blueprint there, and the numbers do exist. There's right. obviously a few things we need to sort out, and mm-hmm. we also need to make it not overly cumbersome for managers to understand, taxpayers to understand, and you to manage. So there are still some things to sort out. Right. But that's what I would be contemplating.
Well, I will say that I find that to be a project. A big. I don't mind projects, but I just like to see the benefit. And to me, I just don't understand how that would be any clearer. And the other problem I was thinking about so you're saying that I would create the budget, and so my budget is $1 million, and I have 100 employees. So I say the average is that what you're doing?
If that's a direct, if an average approach is the way you'd want to do it, then yes, that would be what I would say.
And then the department can just say, Barb, what's the average this year? And I can say it's, you know, $900 a person. And so they say I have 12 employees. So that's my thing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Yeah. Period.
The one exception, the one exception to that, I think, because of its size for the school, is the elementary school. Mm-hmm. They're essentially 60% of the budget, 60% of the salary budget in the town.
Mm-hmm. Well, and that could be handled like South County, where you actually have.
and let in that case, let them literally be responsible for that.
Yes, that
budget
that has been proposed.
The thing is that they are now when it comes to Frontier, the regional school.
Right.
So it's not something.
And I do feel like the school does have a responsibility to know what theirs are because they hire their employees. You know, the selectmen hire these employees and they're conscious not to hire, you know, indiscriminately 22-hour a week people because they know the ramifications and what comes along with all of that. But when you have the school has hires whoever they want and they send them over here for the health insurance and there's a huge disconnect. So I just feel like they're different in that they manage their own, how many employees they have, where a department head doesn't. I have no control over, once the selectmen hire somebody for my department, I have no control over whether they take benefits or not. So I can't, it's not anything I can control.
Well, it's not the school can't control whether they take benefits or not, but they can control whether they hire the person
Correct.
Or not.
Right. That's why I say I just see it more as a hiring
and
choice.
It's the same thing with, and I would do, you know, not only health insurance, but all the benefits. The one thing that we all know is I think everyone in here, if you give them the information, could calculate what the Medicare contribution costs.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty straightforward. In addition to health insurance and you've got the other benefits, the amount that has to go to the retirement.
Mm-hmm.
So they should be budgeting for that too.
Who's they?
The schools.
Oh yeah.
I mean, and right. that certainly is something that ought to be in everybody's each department's budget.
I think it's very important for us to make clear that we're not questioning benefits and, you know, as far as people's rights to have benefits and that. I mean, that's a negotiated contracted item. Mm-hmm. We all agree with that. That's not the issue here. Mm-hmm.
That's a good point.
I just want to make sure the public mm-hmm. understands that. Yeah. That's not being questioned whatsoever. It's just making everybody a little more aware of the total cost. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what this issue is all about.
Exactly.
All right.
Just wanted to clarify that.
I think a $900,000 line item is mm-hmm. pretty obvious. It's a big, you know.
Yeah.
But how many people in town, when they show up to vote in the town meeting, think they could know within 5 or 10% how much of that is, say, the school? I would think very few.
Oh yeah, no, I totally agree.
I think that's the
about
problem,
the
or
yeah.
part
exactly.
of the problem.
Yeah,
exactly.
I totally agree about the school.
And not bringing up the school because it's the school, but just because any large apportionment of mm-hmm. a large line item like that—that's where I think breaking it out and making it more clear.
Yeah,
would be helpful.
I mean, I don't think the school would be interested in breaking it out between phys ed and the cafeteria and the art and the band
No.
Okay. Anything else? For Barbara. Okay, well.
No, you would mention something about stabilization funds.
Yes. okay, I guess this was just if the best, her thoughts on if stabilization funds, general ones or specific stabilization funds or free cash might have different pros and cons for the town to retain or keep money or set aside money for future projects. That was the other one.
About putting free cash into stabilization.
Yes.
Yeah. So I guess I wasn't quite sure you were talking about doing that maybe by the end of before the end of the fiscal year to have it into stabilization for.
Well, I guess let's just use an example. Let's say that we got through with the budget this year and we knew there was going to be $600,000 in free cash. What are the pros and cons of moving forward with that and rolling into next year and having that recertified in the fall versus, let's say, putting $400,000 of that into stabilization and only having $200,000 go through year end and come out the other side in free cash.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any strong view one way or the other on those two?
Well, I guess I pushed to talk about it because Mary's here just to make sure that I have a full understanding of what that would do. So if you're talking about the free cash that we currently have available to us that was certified and it's available to us, we haven't spent it.
Mm-hmm.
So put some of it into stabilization and then it won't be part of a growing free cash next year.
Mm-hmm.
So my only concern with that is I didn't know how much you were talking about if you were trying
to put
a lot.
I know you did. Now, by the way. Yep.
I know you did. But putting large amounts into stabilization makes it so I can't use it to pay bills or do anything. So if you can envision the operating budget is approved for whatever many dollars. Come July 1, a ton of it is paid out right away. our assessments, a lot of assessments are due. We collect taxes in May and typically in December. Really by October, we're pretty tight. November, pretty tight on funds because the operating budget, there's been no receipts, mm-hmm. But there's been a ton of expenditures. Mm-hmm. So I think if the money was all tied up, I would have to borrow.
So then we'd be talking about the increased cost would be in the short-term borrowing expense.
Right. So that's kind of what I was thinking initially when you mentioned that.
Okay.
So you'd have to vote the money to go into stabilization. Yep. So you have to have a vote, and then you'd have to vote to take it out.
Yep.
But you would just be putting it in there so it wouldn't become part of more free cash next year.
So now this ability for you to pay the bills from July 1st through the free cash that carries over, let's say you leave the $600,000 in free cash, mm-hmm. that's still usable even though it's not certified until...
Well, whatever cash is available to us, we have certified free cash.
It's in the right checkbook.
We have certified free cash right now that we haven't spent.
But you won't have it in August.
If there's money in the checkbook and it's Barb has the appropriation from town meeting to spend money as of July 1st, she can spend it.
I have to spend
it. If the money's in the checkbook. And yeah, in most cases, she has to spend it. We have to pay bills as of July 1st.
Right.
Yeah. Is there
there's no pocket of dollars that says, I'm free cash, you can't spend me.
Right.
Yeah.
It's just what's in the checkbook.
Okay.
But stabilization money
is actually in a separate checkbook.
Okay. It would come out of the checkbook and go into stabilization.
Into a savings account, if you will.
Am I stating that right?
Yeah. A savings account that you couldn't take.
Which you can't take back out.
Yeah.
Is there like a five-year average for free cash that's spent on an annual basis, or does that vary?
Well, we really didn't spend much last year, and then the year before we spent.
But I mean, how much do you need year to year to kind of carry yourself along?
Right. A better question would be, what would be a rolling deficit?
Yeah.
What would be a deficit that we hit, the lowest deficit for any given year?
That's what I mean. Yeah.
Mm. Well, we're usually not in a bind until a couple, we're pretty
How little does the checkbook get at times?
Yeah.
Pretty low.
Okay. Right. That answers it.
Right.
Well, until you collect cash.
We're playing with the idea that we can do a little
bit. And then if the tax rate's set late, that's when she gets in a bind.
Would it be possible to look back at, let's say, the last 5 years and look at the free cash number carried through June 30th, and then is there a way to see what the lowest the checkbook got in October, whenever that low point is? Is that data that we have?
Sure. Mm-hmm.
Because maybe that'll give us some idea of, okay, here's at least five instances where we went in with this, mm-hmm. we hit this level, and it was around this week or month time, and that'll give us some idea of kind of what that...
Right. So we know we need to at least maintain X amount of dollars in free cash,
But again,
the additional we may be able to take and do stabilization.
But to be fair, the true cost is really just the interest on the cash you'd have to borrow.
I was going to say, it's the savings... Mm-hmm. versus the interest, if there was savings.
Which is probably close to a wash, whatever you're earning on the stabilization income and whatever you're paying on the short-term.
I suspect
you're earning
money
when it's free cash.
What's that?
You're still earning money when you're...
My checkbook account does not earn anything.
What's that? Oh.
Earnings of free cash in whatever account it's in similar or the same as the earnings of stabilization funds in the account that they're in?
Probably, unless you're going to invest it.
Yeah, that's...
Unless you're going to invest it.
Remember also
October,
that...
In October, you can't invest because until the tax rate's set, she's running on whatever funds are left in her checking account.
Yeah.
And remember also that we're talking about inventions. We're talking about accounting mechanisms here. We're not actually talking about dollars in the bank. Free cash is a number.
Right.
And mm-hmm. you can have free cash in the amount of $850,000 on the books as of June 30th, but you may only have $300,000 in the checkbook.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah.
That's possible. Mm-hmm. It could be that you've got $1.1 million in your checkbook, but you only have available funds of $200,000. Mm-hmm. You know, say midway through the year, after you've gotten a lot of tax money, but we haven't spent a lot, mm-hmm. Spent everything on the expenses we need to spend.
Right.
Oh my God, we've got $2 million, $3 million, $4 million in the account. That looks great, except on books, it only looks like we've got $300,000. That's the idiosyncrasies of accounting. And to say just, how much free cash do we have versus how much we might have in the checkbook, it's a more complex calculation than that.
So
you have to figure out where your expected revenues are at any given point
and where the deficit between that and what actually you've got is at any given point.
So
and it's fairly complex.
Would the hope be that you put it in stabilization so you can invest it because it's going to stay there?
We just, various people, and Doug, I know in one of the preamble to your first budget, had contemplating using stabilization funds more as a place to put money rather than free cash. And I think one of the examples he gave was that free cash, until it's recertified, it's not, there's a window where it's not really free cash. It might be in the checkbook, but it's not certified and can't be used in the same way.
I'm not looking to make any new appropriations. I mean, I'm
no, I know.
Yeah.
And so I guess what this boils down for me anyway, that I'd be looking for you is, we've been told that the state recommends 5% free cash, roughly, based on your budget, which would be somewhere around $750,000. I think we've had some conversations on the committee and felt that. What's that?
$680,000. Based on the operational.
$700,000, let's just use a round number. Mm-hmm. And we felt comfortable maybe down to, say, $500,000, I think, was a number we threw out.
Yeah.
And so with this in mind, I'd love to know your office's opinion of what percentage or dollar amount you feel comfortable with, or range you feel comfortable with, as a minimum carrying over June 30th.
I think that's really it.
So rather than you give us data and us talk, whatever your the Barbara recommendation,
what an appropriate amount of free cash is.
Yes, like at what point, under what amount would you feel somewhat uneasy about the free cash you're going through on June 30th?
Right.
And again, we understand that the ramifications of dipping below is short-term borrowing, not that you're actually out of money. It's a timing issue, not a solvency issue. But still, we'd love to know your opinion on that.
Yeah, it's maybe kind of the highs and lows of
maybe expressing that as a percentage of the overall budget.
Yeah,
I know that when I was running FCAT, I would want to keep 3 months worth of expenses in the bank.
Yeah,
no matter what. And we set out an artificial hard deck, if you would. Even though the checking account said this, I treated that as a zero. Mm-hmm. I said, I'm broke. I got nothing. I can't spend a thing until I get more money coming in.
Well, in this issue, though, she'd have to borrow money because you couldn't get it out of stabilization.
Right, exactly. And that's what I'm suggesting, that's what we're looking for is do we want 1/12 of the annual budget available at any given time as cash in the bank? Do we want that cushion? Is it 1/12? Is it 5%? Is it 4%? What is that amount?
Did you have to borrow this year?
No.
Because we only rolled over $300,000 in free cash.
Mm-hmm.
Well, or less than that.
Yes, but we also know how much of an increase.
And our bills didn't go out as late as they did the year that I had to borrow. So.
Yeah.
And that year I don't remember what the amount in free cash, but the problem that I have with the free cash is we have too much of it.
Right.
In our budgeting process, we wind up generating too much free cash.
That was going to be my question to Dylan, is exactly what your question was to me. Are you saying, how is it that we can assess and tax in a way to not have as much free cash?
Quarterly tax bills.
I didn't roll my eyes.
So... But it does. Solves the problem.
Well, I was going to say, I don't know that the quarterly needs to happen, but maybe even a preliminary first half system where we can send out the first half bills as a preliminary.
Estimated,
much like
and then the second one is...
Is the actual.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Again, I'm trying to work more efficiently, not doing more work to get the same thing done. I don't know.
So
the short spot is sometimes late fall, early winter, when you haven't had a tax bill in quite some time. So rather than creating four additional billings.
All right.
I don't know.
December, I assume, has got to be tough because
It can be.
Taxes haven't, generally speaking, tax bills don't go out until sometime in November, even though the bill is due November 1st, we don't get it out because we don't get everything certified.
Because we don't send it out for October 1,
So, I mean, it's in a lot of ways, it's nice not to have, for me, it's nice not to have that bill go out until December 1st. Then I have a choice. Do I pay it in 1 year or do I pay it the next year?
Right.
Even though it's just a day, it's whether it's 2015 or 2016.
Right.
But that's not a good way for the town to operate.
So I don't know, going into figuring a tighter assessment so that you don't produce more free cash.
Well, producing is an important, but I think separate issue. Forgetting the producing, let's say that we nailed the budget on the screws, and whatever we take in on June 30th, we're coming out with on September, whenever it's recertified. There's also the question of what number does that need or want to be from your standpoint. So I think there's kind of two aspects to this.
I had never really given the thought to a number, so I don't know that I could really guess at one right now.
Okay, well, maybe we can...
Well, I will tell you that the county retirement is a July 1 bill, so that's $500,000.
Out the door.
Okay. Well, I'd be very interested to pursue this idea, you know, outside or after this meeting, or, you know, with you in your office about other tax billing strategies that may increase, may solve part of this problem on its own.
What's the discount that we get on the, for paying the...
10,000?
It's 2%?
It's 8%, isn't it, Barb?
Yeah, it's significant.
It's 8%.
I didn't think it was nearly that much, but it's certainly worth doing.
It's worth doing.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
But again, I guess this whole subject is not really a directive. It's just you people have struggled with this for a long time about free cash and
stabilization.
Yeah, thank you. And so I think, you know, all of these questions to you, Barbara, just, you know, we're struggling with it, and I, you know, a little bit of information, if you can dig it up, might help.
Yeah. I was just asking questions because I was trying to figure out what
underlying
is
plan here. It's just
I just looked at it.
I'm trying to gather information right now.
So let's see, 5059. So $9,000
out of 2%.
Yeah. 505,936, and we pay 496,669. So
9 grand.
Okay.
9 grand.
Well, thank you very much for all your time and all these thoughts. On that last one, I think, you know, again, I think we'll continue that conversation. But this was very helpful, and the budgets was very helpful. We'll follow up on a couple things.
Yes.
We'll let you know if we have any other questions. But thank you for that. So let's see. All right, it is 9:30. I was hoping to get a couple more things done, but I don't think we'll have time unless people want to power through another 10 or 15 minutes. I don't think so. Let's just spend 2 minutes on planning next week's meeting. So we were talking about doing the meeting next week on Monday. The reason being Tuesday is elections. Wouldn't be able to have it here. The other reason being I'd like to have kind of a preliminary budget overview as maybe the second half of that meeting. We'll go through a few budgets in the beginning and then kind of talk about the overall budget. And I thought that might be helpful before people go to vote for overrides and debt exclusions and, or I guess debt exclusion the following day. Anyone have any problem with, can anybody or everybody do Monday? I know Ralph, you might not be able to.
Yeah.
I can.
You're here. Yeah. I think John's back. You're in. I'm in. Okay.
Just so, have to let Bill
more,
know.
It's more than likely I can, but it just may be a little bit late.
Well, I hope that you can. I think it'll be a good meeting. So let's plan for next Monday at 6:30. After that, we'll go back to our Tuesday meetings. And okay, that's all I have, Doug. Do you have anything else for us for tonight?
Two things. Be aware that I'll be getting you updated budget sheets, probably a full budget packet, probably for your meeting on Monday. A significant number of numbers have changed, including revenues, as well as contracted services for a number of reasons, which I won't go into tonight. As it stands right now, my bottom line reads 15,242,409. That is not accurate because I do not have a full accounting of the CIPC capital requests and what they've approved. We also need to get the loan numbers for the DES roof straight as well. And I have to determine if we're going to be going out for a bond for the headworks project that for the wastewater treatment plant. That being said, granted, that's a couple $100,000 some one way or the other. The budget right now retains $550,000 in free cash and puts $350,000 into a capital stabilization. So out of the 1.4 million of free cash, we're using about 650.
Okay. You passed these out to me, these budget summaries?
Yes.
Do you want me to pass them out, or are those numbers changing? Should I just wait and we can all look at the ones next week?
If you want to pass them out, that was a snapshot right before the meeting.
Do people want stale numbers or good numbers next week?
No, I'll take whatever we've got. I mean, they're always going to change.
I haven't looked at it either.
I would like to get them. Sure.
I think you got one extra. You can have it. Let me just get a couple of things to pass out.
I don't need one.
South County EMS budget, this is the one they passed, so this should be good.
That's
other
correct.
Than we may have to revisit some of Barbara's numbers to them.
A quick text to Zach says that he used the formulas that were established by Barb and Brenda for both health insurance and for retirement.
Okay. Well, we'll
or for retirement and Medicare, I mean. So
we'll let them sort out if there are differences, yep. and whatever they agree to is what we'll put in. Yep. And then this was, what is this?
So what happened to the $1 figure that?
You're bad.
I'm thinking of the immortal words.
This is, Ralph, that's for you.
Lieutenant Schultz.
I don't know why they were stapled together, so that's why they're getting ripped.
Can I go ask Tom for the difference?
I know
the difference?
Nothing.
Ask if he's still going to pay the difference, or is he backed out on that?
These are, skip. These are South County EMS additional information, capital account, and retained earnings. Okay, so we'll probably have a couple more weeks like this, bringing people in, going through stuff, trying to get Kevin on the docket will be a big one, and line up Zach and those guys to come in from South County as well. Anything else? All right, well, thanks for the long hours tonight, guys, but I think we made a lot of progress. I'd entertain a motion to adjourn.
Second.
So moved. Any second?
Second.
All those in favor?
All right.
All right. Thank you.